This is a production of SDPB.
Touchdown! This is for a state championship. Oh, direct kick, and it's good!
There's going to be some highlights coming off of this.
The short-range jumper.
Edging out in lane four, the top seed.
This South Dakota High School State Championship event is conducted under the direction of the South Dakota High School Activities Association.
The season started in early December. It's been a long road for many teams, and it all leads to tonight. Championship Saturday night here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toombe. This is the championship night for Class AA girls basketball here on SDPB3. We've got two games coming at you tonight. The third place game will be first. It's a rematch of last year's third place game, and then the championship game later on tonight. One of these teams is expecting, or is trying to get, an undefeated season. Nate, it has been a fun day today so far here on the final day of the season. We had some good action in the consolation games earlier today, and that leads us into tonight with the Cavaliers and the Tigers battling for third place yet again. And then O'Gorman trying to cap off an unbeaten season, taking on Brandon Valley. What semifinals, dominated by the Knights and the Lynx. They were dominant in their semifinals.
Yeah, no question. And you have two teams in front of us here right now with Harrisburg and Jefferson, who both had successful seasons and probably felt like they didn't play their best last night, probably felt like they didn't execute their best. And so they want to come out here in this last game of the season and really prove the type of team that they are. Probably wasn't the one yesterday. It was that previous 21-22 games that we've seen from them.
Harrisburg came in as the 7th seed under head coach Nick Meyer. He is a coach that's been there for several years. Harrisburg runner-up back-to-back years in 2017 and 2018, third place in 2019. Last year they got fourth place, losing to Sioux Falls Jefferson. Take a look at the regular season there. They do own a victory over Jefferson. That happened back on January the 18th. They beat Washington to get into the state tournament. Had a good game against Mitchell to open things up, but fell last night to Brandon Valley. Abigail Flanagan, Addie Wagner, Jaylee Hofer, McKinley Lorenzen, Sadie Merman. That's your starting lineup. Three seniors, a junior, and a sophomore for the Tigers.
After shooting the absolute lights out of it on Thursday night against Mitchell, 10 of 20 from three, they just couldn't get much going last night against Brandon Valley. Only 1 of 11 from three, 25% overall from the field goal.
Let's meet the Cavaliers in their third year of existence. Shantiva Pruitt is their head coach. She, of course, a standout player at Roosevelt, later on for Augie, if I remember correctly, and also a Spirit of Sioux winner from her high school days in her senior year. We'll mention more about that later on tonight. They've had a very good campaign. They had a win over Brandon Valley during the regular season, and then they beat Watertown in the SODAC 16 round. They held off a rally from Pierre late to win, but then that third quarter did them in last night against O'Gorman.
Yeah, value on the basketball so far in both games for them. 22 turnovers, and they did just enough on Thursday against Pierre, but it really bit them last night. Just that ball security, and that's something to watch for here this evening. Value in each possession, making sure that they're getting scoring opportunities every time that they have the basketball.
Altenberg, Johnson, Dunn, Horner, and McGovern Harrington, the starting five for the Cavaliers. And we expect a pretty good game here tonight. Last year in the third place game, Harrisburg won by 21 points. It'll be interesting to see what happens in this particular matchup. Both teams right about the same scoring average, 54 points per game for the Tigers, 53 points per game for the Sioux Falls Jefferson Cavaliers. Well, we are ready to get things started. Our final session for this year's 2023-2024 season of basketball, Class AA basketball tournament, right here on SDPB3. Greg Thompson, he's our public address announcer, and he'll take us through the pregame ceremonies.
Good evening, basketball fans. The South Dakota High School Activities Association welcomes you to this third place game in the State Girls AA High School Basketball Tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activities Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you enjoy this game and support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. This game features the Tigers of Harrisburg and the Cavaliers of Jefferson. Ladies and gentlemen, we please stand, remove your hats as we honor America with the singing of our national anthem. Singing tonight will be Michaela Jones and Sydney Birch from Eureka High School. Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem.
So proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the
And now, let's begin this game in alternating fashion. For the Tigers, at guard, a 5'7", senior number two, Addie Wagner. For the Cavaliers, at guard, a 5'6", senior number one, Aaliyah McGovern. For the Tigers, at guard, a 5'5", senior number four, Jaylee Hofer. For the Cavaliers at forward, a 5'9", sophomore, number 13, Abby Horner. For the Tigers at guard, a 5'11", senior, number 11, Abby Flanagan. For the Cavaliers at forward, a 6'1", senior, number 21, Jaden Dunn. For the Tigers at guard, a 5'10", sophomore, number 14, Sadie Berman. For the Cavaliers, at guard, a 5'7", senior, number 23, Ashlyn Johnson. And for the Tigers, at forward, a 5'10", junior, number 20, McKinley Lorenzen. For the Cavaliers, at guard, a 5'10", freshman, number 24, Brinley Altenberg. The Tigers are led by Nick Meyer. Assistant coaches, Dana Biggie, Brittany Rosberg, Haley Halling, and Mick Zeman. The Cavaliers are led by Shantiva Pruitt. Assistant coaches Derek Dunn, Sarah Zirpel, Mark Eisenbry, Ethan Fries, and Paige Beck. Your officials for this game, Jason Reisdorfer, Eric Groka, and Rusty Keith.
Here we go, hit the lights, we're ready for the third place game between Harrisburg and Sioux Falls Jefferson. Harrisburg, the road, burgundy reds, the home whites for the Cavaliers, tip controlled by Harrisburg.
And offense was hard to come by for Harrisburg yesterday. We'll see if they can get into a little bit of a rhythm earlier on tonight.
Zone for Jefferson. They go right underneath and the shot missed, but Flanagan gets the rebound. Hofer, three, short. Rebound, McGovern. Long pass up ahead, Altenburg was open. The defense is back there, shot in and out, back in again.
With the quick stop and pop by Brindley Altenburg.
Lady is just a freshman and very impressive.
Yeah, I had 15 last night. The night prior, 13.
Shot missed by the Tigers. Here comes McGovern down the lane. No shot from the corner there for Horner, but Altenburg sizes up a three. It's off the mark. Rebound loose on the floor. It's out of bounds. It will go to Harrisburg.
And Altenburg's just so dangerous at all three levels that you got to be keyed onto her exactly where she's at on the court the entire time. Here Jefferson drops back in a little three-quarter court to their half-court zone.
See what the Tigers have cooked up. Merman was held pretty much in check last night with just 3 points. And there's a pass into the paint tapped away by the Cavaliers. Trouble in the backcourt, but a foul is going to be called on Flanagan. That is her first.
Harrisburg really needs to look. They saw it against Brandon Valley last night. A lot of half-court zone where they got a little stagnant. That ball really wasn't popping and moving as quickly as you'd like against the zone. It's something that they definitely need to improve if they want to have success this evening.
Looking forward to that matchup in the paint between Lorenzen and Dunn.
They get a switch on that high ball screen. Dunn's got Merman Gardner inside.
Trying to get the ball to Dunn. No can do there. Merman does have some height, but Dunn, the stronger player, missed that shot. And the rebound comes down to Hofer. Good box out there by Merman.
Got the matchup that you wanted right there.
Well, Merman at 5'10". Well, not a short player by any stretch of the imagination. If you figure Lorenzen's going to be the primary defender against Dunn in the paint for Harrisburg. Oh, backdoor cut off the mark. And the turnover gives the ball to the Cavaliers.
And you like to see Hofer. She kind of passed up after missing the first one. She passed up a decent look there. She needs to be a threat against the zone.
Altenburg brings it up, signals out the play. Gives way to McGovern. Man-to-man for Harrisburg. McGovern so quick with that first step. That shot was blocked. And Harrisburg comes away with it. Hofer, 21 the first night, held to just 3 last night.
Will be interesting to see if Jefferson last night. There's Hofer. Yes, sir.
That's what we saw a lot of the first night from Jay Lee Hofer. Young lady who is a standout soccer player is going to Northern to play soccer, was part of that team that won back-to-back championships. Flanagan, Hofer, and Lindsay Worth all on that team. It's been very successful for Harrisburg on the soccer field.
Lawrenson did a great job of staying on her feet. Dunn was trying to create an angle. Didn't work.
Merman with the drive. And that's taken away by Altenburg. Cavaliers on the run. And it's handed right back to Harrisburg.
Trying to go to Ashlyn Johnson running the floor.
Here's the open shooter, but Wagner just couldn't pull the trigger in time before the defense got there. And she stepped out of bounds. Timeout on the court. 4:23 left. Low scoring game with Harrisburg on top, 3-2. Back in a moment, right here on SDPB 3.
We hope you're a fan of stories about heroes, because we'd like you to meet a few of ours. These folks keep our communities moving forward. They're dedicated to being here for you, navigating change, keeping you secure, and offering a helping hand to those who need it. Heroes come from many walks. Ours are here to walk with you. Go with trust. Go with people. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out as I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
And we're ready to go here. First quarter continuing along with Nate Kading. I'm Steve Toome. Great to have you here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls Heritage Court, the site of this year's state AA girls basketball tournament. Pressure applied. Altenburg gets the inbounds, lobs it ahead to McGovern. Numbers for the Cavaliers. And Harrisburg gets back quickly.
Drops back right into their just half court man, which we've seen out of them essentially the entire tournament.
Dunn on the perimeter handles it. Scoring drought over 3 minutes for the Cavaliers, and an errant pass gives it back to the Tigers.
Yeah, we talked at the beginning, 22 turnovers for the Cavs in both their first and semifinal games. That's an area that they need to make sure that they're locking in on and really taking care of that basketball.
In case you missed it earlier, Spearfish had 2 turnovers the entire game in their 7th place win against Stevens. I don't know if that'll ever be repeated. I think the coaches may want to examine the film of what Dakota Johnson and her crew did there and figure out what they did right, because 2 turnovers in a high school basketball game, boys or girls, is practically unheard of.
Phenomenal.
And, yep, Spearfish winning earlier today. They took 7th place. Pier took 5th place.
Yeah, and both teams taking a little time to get in an offensive rhythm. Jefferson 1 of 5. There's Altenburg again, 1 of 6. Harrisburg 1 of 4 already with 5 turnovers. There should be an easy one.
Double dribble. Wagner couldn't quite handle that pass from Flanagan. It was a good decision, but just maybe a little off the mark.
Yeah, great over the top look in transition. And a lot of the times that's how you can get yourself going a little bit. Get a couple easy ones, transition, offensive rebounds, find your way to the foul line.
Johnson with the ball. She's headed to Dakota Wesleyan for soccer. A long three, good! Altenburg, that's Steph Curry range there, folks. She was a good, what, 2 steps beyond that top arc.
That was deep, yeah. She has unlimited range, unlimited conscience. That's the nice thing about Brinley Altenburg. Even if she misses a field, that next wide open shot is going up.
Shooter's mentality, next one's gonna go in. Gotta have that mentality. Johnson with the ball, Dunn beyond her reach, out of bounds. Dunn heading to South Dakota State. Play basketball, wants to study genetics.
2 times there, they're trying to hit Dunn just a little over the top. Oftentimes it can be better, work on your angle, even if you gotta take a bounce over there, deliver the bounce pass, make sure it's a sure pass. She's getting good position in there, let her go to work.
Under 2.5 here, 5-3 Cavaliers. Hofer couldn't quite pull the trigger, she's got the only bucket. That was a tray earlier on. Flanagan has to reach back and grab that one. Floats it up and in. Nice move by Abigail Flanagan.
Good aggressive attack by Flanagan.
Flanagan heading to USF to play soccer.
Yeah, she's been consistent. Had 10 last night, 13 the night before. She's somebody averages double figures or near double figures.
It's tapped away by Flanagan into the hands of Bryn Van Bocker, number 3, who just checked in. Van Bocker handles it. Go down the lane, it's wide open, but Dunn erases that one.
Such a luxury to have a rim protector and a paint presence such as Jaden Dunn.
Who's quick, great athleticism.
Here they're trying to set her diagonal screen. Top down, high low pass. Flanagan does an excellent job. She was the low person defensively, coming over the top, most important player on the floor, that low person when they're throwing the ball over the top.
Now the freshman is in number 33, Leslie Young-Setzer for Harrisburg. There's the switch. There's the mismatch with Hofer trying to guard Dunn. And the pass is over everybody's head, out of bounds.
Same thing as we've seen a couple times. They're trying to throw those at a bit of some awkward angles, and rather than dribbling away from it, dribble back to it. Little sure passers from the Cavaliers.
Here's a shot. Van Bockeren misses the three, but there's Wagner on the weak side, and we got a jump ball. Possession arrow, Tigers. Under a minute to go here, quarter number one.
Screen in for Hofer as the inbounder, and there's
Young-Setzer
with the nice left hand, offhand finish right there.
Shot clock, game clock, about a second difference. Let's see if the Cavaliers play for one. Altenberg has the switch. Now you have a guard against Dunn in the paint. They'll lob it to her, but Van Bockeren steps in the way, makes the great defensive play.
Great job getting around to the front there by Van Bockeren. That's what you want to see against the mismatch.
Flanagan down the lane, scoops it up high off the window. No, and a few seconds left here. Altenberg on the move. 3 seconds, pulls up. Yes. That's out of the first quarter within. Altenberg with all 7 points for the Cavaliers. Three different players have scored for the Tigers. Back with the second quarter after this timeout here on SDPB3.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Oh my goodness.
Some of the fans here for Championship Saturday night in attendance at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls, along with Nate Kading. I'm Steve Toon. Great to have you here. 7-7 after one. Both teams 6 turnovers. Shooting stats relatively even. 3 of 10 for Harrisburg. 3 of 8 for the Cavaliers.
Yeah, you have two teams that obviously are familiar with one another, both in the Sioux Falls area, played against each other in the regular season. Coaches are going to have them well-prepared personnel-wise, scheme-wise, and there's Horner with a nice up fake as Setzer gets switched on and goes flying by. And Abby Horner, who's been dynamite on the glass, has not been a huge offensive presence in providing a ton of production, so that's a bonus for the Cavaliers.
Yep, that's only her 4th point of the tournament. She did have 11 rebounds in that first game. Pass tipped, but it gets to Merman. Here's a three on the way, good, by Flanagan.
You had Flanagan, who was at the high post, and as Merman takes that ball to the right, relocates beyond the arc, it's great action.
10-9, Harrisburg on top as Altenberg, almost had it taken away, and that's gonna be a foul on Flanagan, her 2nd. And Flanagan's going to have to check out in favor of Jaylee Hofer. Hofer wants to study human performance and fitness, going to Northern State. Plays soccer as well. Hofer, one of the captains on this team.
Another high ball screen situation for Altenberg, which we see a bunch of. Followed by the 2nd one for Silvernail. Yeah, trying to go into Dunn again. Just loses her footing.
Another turnover for the Cavaliers, and here's a shot at short. Rebound comes down to Horner. Horner on the move. In trouble at half court, but gets away. Altenburg lost the handle, and it's off a Harrisburg player out of bounds.
Timely dig. Jaylee Hofer is matched up with Ashton Johnson in the corner. Peels off her, gets a dig on Altenburg. Otherwise, that was going to be an easy two.
Altenburg's going to get a break here. McGovern in along with Wagner. And it'll be McGovern running the show. A three, it's going to be off the mark, and that's out of bounds. It did not touch anything.
Yeah, McGovern's been good for this team here. Just steady. Had 8 points last night. Night prior, she had 12 points.
She averages almost 8 points a game. She's headed off to Dakota Wesleyan to play basketball. Also wants to study nursing. Missed three there. Rebounding foul will be on Addie Wagner, and that is her first.
Had a few three-point attempts that are just coming up a little short. You know, keep in mind these athletes, they're young, but three games in three days still matters, and that's why both teams probably want to utilize some bench resources as best they can.
Yep, three intense games in 3 days. Horner on the drive. Shut down there. Has to get it outside to player that just checked in for
shot clock's Harrisburg. Winding down under 10, and that's a great duck in there by Dunn. Great duck in, deep touch. Goes to that lefty finish.
And we're going to have ball skip away, that interior pass. Ava Silvernail just checking in there for the Cavaliers. She is a senior.
I think we had a Silvernail for Silvernail, their yep. Substitution as she got her younger sister, Taylor.
Yep, Taylor wears number 3. Ava wears number 2. Hofer, there's Lorenzen. Offensive foul. Too much body there.
Horner slides in there, taking the tough charge.
First yeah. Foul on Lorenzen.
Yeah.
Third team foul on Harrisburg. Johnson hands off to McGovern. Coming up on the 5 minute mark here until halftime.
The key is always, whenever Altenburg's off the floor, Horner's got to be more aggressive. The same thing.
Oh, did it again.
Did it again with the shot fake.
And this is a timeout called by Harrisburg. We'll keep it here with 4:56 left as Young Setzer got deceived again up in the air, and that's an easy one off the window for Abby Horner.
Oftentimes as the primary defender on the ball, you want to slide your feet, you want to stay down, and you want to wall up. You're not going to be a big-time shot blocker. That's a lot of the times coming from the backside.
You can follow SDPB Sports on your mobile device all season long. Check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And be sure to check out all our action and award photos by searching for SDPB on Flickr. Tell us where you're watching us from and read some of our great stories. Watch some of the videos that features the teams, the players, and the coaches here in South Dakota. At SDPB Sports, hashtag SDHoops24.
Horner providing them some added offensive punch with four early ones here in the first half.
Merman's going to bring it up court. Now to the corner in Van Bockern. Trying to post up Lorenzen. Match up against Johnson. Now Dunn switches over. Merman. She's bottled up. Still 12 on the shot clock. Merman is going to be fouled, and that'll be the first foul on the Cavaliers, and that will be assessed to Aaliyah McGovern. Timeout on the court. 4:30 left until the break. Jefferson up by 3. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. You're watching SDPB 3.
sometimes having 15 of something is great. Like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live, where you work. Community is being there for each other, lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
Jefferson up 13-10, a defensive game here for the third place between the Cavaliers and the Tigers, along with Nate Kading. I'm Steve Toon. Great to have you here on a Saturday night, championship Saturday night, here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls.
Jefferson comes out the timeout and man-to-man, been in zone of much of this game.
Renson guarded by Johnson in the paint. Trying to get the ball to her. Now Johnson plays taller than what she's listed as.
Yeah, so strong. Good leverage inside. There they find Lawrenson.
But missed the shot with the left hand. Here comes Silvernail up court.
Silvernail giving them some good minutes. Hasn't played much in this tournament up until this point.
There's Dunn backing down into a double team. Has to kick it out right away. Under 10 on the shot clock. Horner is in trouble. Dunn turns around. No, gets her own rebound. Yes.
And that's where you really want to see when Merman's walling up. You're on. Harrisburg had two other teammates that were around that free throw line. They need to rebound down the basketball floor, clean up that miss.
Van Bockern on the perimeter. Wagner drives from the left side. See if they'll go to the right side. No, they go back left. Five on the shot clock. Shot is blocked by Silvernail. Under 3 minutes to go.
Harrisburg just struggling, getting comfortable again against zone defense.
Johnson tries to put up a shot, misses. Here comes Hofer the other way. Throws it outside, wide open. Van Bockern three is short, but there's Lorenzen to scoop it out of the air off of Wagner's hands. And she shovels it away, and Merman going to go for travel. Feet shot, she got fouled. And it's going to go to Jefferson.
It was a tough one there. You're always in between. You talk about as a coach being the first to the floor for a loose ball, but when you got nobody else around you, you're in between picking it up or diving on it. And there, tried picking it up and then had a little contact and had to dive on it.
They'll lob it to Dunn. Turns. No. Tip to the outside and out of bounds. Last touch by Harrisburg.
It's great to see the focus of Jefferson, especially here in the second quarter, of pounding that basketball inside. Dunn, such a weapon in there and can create for other people.
There's a three that's on the way. No good. Long rebound out of bounds. It goes to the Tigers. 2:05 left. Harrisburg hasn't scored in over 5 minutes. They have missed their last five field goals. That one's blocked. Throw it to the outside. Merman has to track it down.
Shot clock still winding down.
Yep, never touched the rim. Didn't even get close. 10 seconds left. Now Flanagan. Hofer for three. It's going to be short, and the rebound done. Good defensive stand by the Cavaliers.
A
Altenburg lobs it in, and it bounces off a couple of players, Harrisburg players, intended for Cameron Whiting. She is a senior. Plans on going to Augie to study education.
Harrisburg is doing a decent job when they get mismatched of working around to a front and having that backside help. A couple times Dunn's taking advantage of just deep touches when they haven't done that, but they've executed correctly a number of different times so far yet tonight.
Dunn lost the handle. Johnson for three, in and out, no good. Outlet, Hofer on the move. Into the paint, lobs it up, no. And there is Horner with the rebound. Swing it around to Altenburg, a three, yes! She has 10. And the lead is 8. Tigers need something here in the waning moments. About a 4-second difference between shot clock and game clock. Inside, Lorenzen all alone scores her first points of the night. Fourth different player to score for the Tigers. Shot clock off, under 20 seconds. McGovern slowly into the front court. See if they'll find Altenburg. They're gonna go down low to Johnson in the paint, no. Rebound comes down to Hofer. She will not have time to advance, and it's 18-12 in favor of Sioux Falls Jefferson here at the break. They outscore Harrisburg 11-5 in that second quarter of play after being tied at 7 after the end of the first period of play. But excellent defense. Harrisburg 1-for-9 on their last 9 attempts. They only made one of them. Let's send it over to Nate Kading.
Obviously holding Harrisburg to 12 points at half. What was your primary focus defensively coming into this game, and why is it working so well?
Yeah, they have a ton of shooters. So, you know, we're trying to be in that zone but get to shooters and make it hard for them. We got to continue to do that and then box out. They can only have one shot. That's something that's hard to do out of a zone, but I think we're doing a pretty good job of that.
Yeah, offensively, it's been kind of a grind on both sides. You're able to open it up a little bit in the second quarter. What are you looking for in the second half on that side of the floor?
Yeah, we just need to play inside out. You know, Jaden Dunn is an amazing post, and we need to get the ball inside. Good things happen then, okay? Whether it's her scoring or whether it's kicking out. So if we can continue to do that and then push the basketball and misses.
Thanks for your time. Best of luck this second half.
Thank you, Nate. We'll take a break. Come back with more here from the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. You're watching SDPB3.
Dreamer. Doer. Difference maker. These are just a few things we look for when growing our team at Dakota Bank. Those with empathy and a commitment to doing what's right build their careers with us. If you're about relationships and helping others, Dakota Bank is calling. Will you answer? Go with integrity. Go with teamwork. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is as I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Coverage of the South Dakota High School Activities Association event is made possible by a partnership between the SDHSAA and SDPB. Sponsors of SDPB's coverage include Dakota Bank, South Dakota Corn, and by Lloyd Companies, Bank West, South Dakota State University, the South Dakota Department of Education, and by your membership in the Friends of SDPB.
Well, welcome back to the Pentagon here in Sioux Falls. Sioux Falls Jefferson leading Harrisburg at the break for third place. 18-12 is our score at the moment. Let's check out some of these highlights from the first half. As Brindley Altenberg has been the story. Also as the defense. There's Jaylee Hofer knocking down a three-pointer. That was the first basket by Harrisburg, but baskets were kind of hard to come by after that for the Tigers as Altenberg knocks down the three. Van Bocker and swatted away by Dunn with the big block. There was Flanagan who hit a three, but she had to leave the game with foul trouble. Dunn posting up, got it with the left hand. Nice move in the paint there. And there was Horner with the shot. She had four big points. A couple of nice fakes. There's Dunn staying with it, getting another basket. She had 4 points in the first half. Altenberg has been the story. She has 10 of their 18 points, including a couple of three-pointers. Checking out the stats, Jefferson 8 of 20 from the floor, 5 of 20. That's a 40% to 25% shooting differential. Three-pointers, even up there. Nobody's gone to the free throw line yet. Rebounds even, turnovers even. Only three players have scored for Jefferson. Altenberg 10. Horner and Dunn each with four. Meanwhile, five for Flanagan to lead the way, three for Hofer, two each for Lorenzen and for Leslie Young-Setzer. That's how things stack up here in this first half of play. We'll take a timeout and come back with more at halftime of this third place game on Championship Saturday night. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. You're watching SDPB3.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
At Bank West, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. Building a future filled with opportunity. Bank West.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do, and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
Beginning April 6th, watch SDPB Saturday evenings for a new lineup of shows. Start the night laughing with Keeping Up Appearances at 5, 4 Mountain. Then, the drama unfolds with back-to-back episodes of Midsummer Murders. Tag along with private investigator Alexa Cross in My Life is Murder at 7, 6 Mountain, followed by the fan favorites Doc Martin and Father Brown. Plus, Sister Boniface joins us on Sunday evenings at 6, 5 Mountain.
And welcome back to the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. We're at halftime of this third place game. It's Sioux Falls Jefferson 18 and Harrisburg 12 at the moment. Nate Koenig standing by with Coach Nick Meyer.
Coach, offense was hard to come by, honestly, for both teams for a good portion of that game. What did you guys talk about at half to hopefully get your team going a little bit on that side of the floor?
I think maybe being a little bit more in attack mode offensively. I think we're catching the ball and kind of putting it above our head, and that makes us a single threat player instead of a triple threat player. So we talked a little bit about that, and I said, you know, our shots aren't terrible. It's just maybe we need to move the ball maybe a little bit better. I thought defensively we were really good in that first half, causing a lot of turnovers. Yeah, they got some good shots inside, but I thought we did a really nice job on that end of the floor. We got to back it up on the offensive end this half.
Appreciate the time. Best of luck this second half. Thanks.
Thank you, Nate. We got an update from the A tournament. They're getting close to halftime. A much higher scoring affair up in Brookings. Sioux Falls Christian and Sisseton doing battle there for third place. And there are less than a minute to go until halftime. Sioux Falls Christian ahead of Sisseton, 32-31 at the moment. Here it is an 18-12 game between Jefferson and Harrisburg. You know, high school basketball is a huge part of what represents our communities and towns here in South Dakota. And tonight you can join us as we take a journey with you into some of the stories, the players, and the teams that surround our basketball courts here in the Mount Rushmore State. From honoring a longtime coach to a student manager whose skills extend to a much different kind of court, we'll also meet a player with who's turned a coach and see how one student athlete is dealing with a unique disability. All this and more on this year's edition of Tales from the Hardwood. That will air after the championship game on SDPB 1 tonight. After Class B wraps up, they are playing out West River. They have yet to get their session underway out in Rapid City. Tales from the Hardwood, also watch it online, sdpb.org. All right, Nate, what did you see there in the first half? And after you got a chance to talk to both coaches, what vibe do you have?
Yeah, I mean, both honestly aren't, anytime you're holding somebody to 18 points or 12 points in a half, you can't hate what you're doing defensively at all. A lot is kind of trying to get both of them going offensively, and we just saw a little bit more from the Cavaliers in that second quarter when they were playing inside out through Jaden Dunn. And that's something that Harrisburg needs to, as we've talked about a few different times, they're consistently getting put in those situations with the ball screen and the switches and Jaden Dunn hard rolls. They've covered it up about 50-60% of the time. The other times she's got some easy ones, which is also created for Altenburg.
We'll see how the first few minutes play out here. That's always such a telltale indicator. We saw that last night when Jefferson was playing O'Gorman. That was a 3-point game, I believe, at halftime, and all of a sudden O'Gorman was off to the races and they left Jefferson in the dust.
Yeah, Harrisburg just needs to loosen up a little bit. The last two games for them have just been a struggle offensively, and they just got to kind of let it go here a little bit and stay aggressive, take care of the basketball, and hopefully see some shots go down.
Tigers open the period with the basketball. Right away into the paint. Here's Flanagan on the move, but she lost the handle. A turnover for the Tigers.
Tried to go Lawrenson right to a cutting Flanagan. Right idea. Just couldn't quite execute. And there they end up giving it back.
Tried to go backdoor to Altenburg. Well played by the Tiger defense.
Here's where you'd like to see when they get that turnover, and there they find Flanagan, who gets the bounce in the roll. Her second one of the game from three, 8 total on the night.
The iron was kind on that one. Shooter's touch there for Flanagan.
We've seen those friendly Pentagon rims here a few times this weekend.
We'll give and go with McGovern, now outside to Johnson. Altenburg will take control at the head of the lane.
Merman's been tasked on Altenburg there. Lawrenson does a great job of getting a deflection. High hands on the switch.
Flanagan drives too strong, and Herr Lawrenson saves it to a teammate. Hole for three. Bingo!
Quick 6-0 run, and Coach Pruitt wants a timeout.
We are tied at 18. A great start to quarter number three for the Tigers. Let's take a look at that last sequence there as Lawrenson saved it to a teammate. It looked like the Jefferson defense caught a little flat-footed there.
Yeah, and you love to see from an offensive perspective, the last two made shots from Harrisburg, the shooters were shot ready, they were down, they were locked and loaded, there was no hesitation when that ball hit their hands, and they were just going right into rhythm. And those two for them are certainly capable, Flanagan and Hofer out there, and they need to be consistent threats against the zone. And that's where the ball can get moving quickly. It finds that shooter's hand, especially in rhythm. You want them getting their feet set and knocking it down with confidence.
Points in the paint, relatively even. Turnovers are even, but points off turnovers, 10-5 advantage Tigers. Rebounding advantage, plus two, Harrisburg. And a couple of three-pointers have evened things up here in quarter number three. Let's see how the Cavaliers respond.
Yeah, Harrisburg is getting it going a little bit more like they were Thursday when they hit 10 threes in comparison to the one that they had last night.
Johnson advancing, lobs it ahead, gets it to Horner. Altenburg is open for three, no. Rebound, Merman had it tapped out of her hands by Johnson. It'll go to the Tigers.
You try to fight against it as a coach as much as possible, but human nature, when you start making a few shots, your defensive effort and your intensity just generally heightens, even if it's just minuscule a little bit. And I think that's what you're seeing here too from the Harrisburg Tigers.
Flanagan at the elbow. No shot from Merman. Still got time. 12 on the shot clock. Here's Flanagan. Hook shot, no. Flanagan went down.
Hits the ground. Jane Dunn leading the break, showing her ball handling ability. Oh, with the nice.
Coast to coast.
Right to left crossover. Finished with the lefty finish.
Don't see too many 6'1", 6'2 players at the high school level do that.
Well, got a glimpse of why she's heading up to Brookings next year.
Hofer scanning the court. Gives way to Flanagan. Merman finds the open shooter. It's Wagner. Yes.
I'd love to see Wagner. The hands were loaded. Even off that first drive when they didn't hit her immediately, she was just waiting for that thing to hit her hands.
Merman commits the foul, and that'll be her first, team's first. Timeout on the court. We got a good one here. Harrisburg up by one. We'll be back in a moment right here on SDPB3.
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour. You know, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and, you know.
Menacing, menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental, so they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal. All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
We're all going somewhere. Going higher, faster, farther. Going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring. Keep making memories. Keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
Under 5 minutes to go, third quarter here, third place on the line of Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toome. Harrisburg is down by six at the break, but now they're up by one.
Feels like an offensive onslaught from Harrisburg that's almost here, not even halfway through the third quarter, have almost doubled up their initial first half total and have outscored the Cavaliers 9-2 here so far in this stanza.
All on three-pointers for Harrisburg. Corner. Dribbles around to her right. Now McGovern the other way. Johnson thought about the three.
Yeah, Lawrenson and Dunn are just two big, strong players banging inside.
The three is good by Johnson.
That's what Coach Brewer was talking about, that inside-out activity. Quick post touch. Quick out to Ashlyn Johnson, wide open three.
Her first points of the contest. Now the Cavaliers are up. Hofer chased by Johnson. Wagner couldn't pull the trigger. Here's the cutter and Flanagan the layup.
Gorgeous, gorgeous. You get that post to post, big to big, enter the weak side cut, backside of the rim.
10 now for Flanagan. Matches Altenburg as the game's high scorer. Johnson pulls it back out. Shot clock winding down at 12 now and counting. Altenburg is open for three. No. Rebound Lorenzen.
Tigers get a bit fortunate right there. Merman was thinking that a switch was going to come on that ball screen, and Altenburg just a little off to the right.
And we're going to have some free throws coming up for Flanagan, who took it right to the rim again.
Flanagan's really made her presence felt here so far tonight. 4 of 9 from the floor, 2 of 2 from three, leading them in scoring with 10 so far, working on 11 right here.
Dunn got the foul her first. Believe it or not, that's only the second foul overall called against Jefferson in this game.
Yeah, official, like I overall on both sides right now, the officials are letting a little physical contact go, especially in the interior with Lawrenson and Jaden Dunn working against one another.
Got that one, but this game nowhere near as physical as Pierre and Mitchell earlier
and especially not out on the perimeter and with the full court presses. It's kind of unusual. I feel like every game we've almost done this tournament, there's been a lot of pressing in full court, where these two teams have been more half court styles defensively.
Another great fake, and that time we're gonna have a foul going the other way, as it was Flanagan who took it away.
Horner almost had her third up and under there, and Flanagan, as she was swiping down, got a piece of the basketball.
Dunn, her second personal foul. Flanagan, guarded by Horner. Trying to find a teammate, and a timeout called by Harrisburg to save the possession. It's a quick 30-second timeout.
Yeah, after Harrisburg hits those early threes here this quarter, you're seeing the Cavaliers go more into a man-to-man defense half in the half court. You saw it right there.
Don't forget, we got boys basketball coming up next week on Thursday the 14th. We'll get things underway on SDPB. Class B will be on SDPB 1, Class A on SDPB 2, that'll be out in Rapid City, and Class AA will be just a few miles away from here, that'll be at the Sanford Premier Center, that'll be on SDPB 3. You can watch all the games online at sdpb.org. and hello to everyone around the world, wherever you may be watching us from. We know that we reach around the world. We have fans all over, and of course, members of our military serving overseas. Thank you for your service. We hope this slice of home is just what the doctor ordered for you.
Speaking of the boys tournaments coming up, we've got a couple participants in the stands. Sadie Merman's brother Jacoby, and I've seen Alex Squires from Sioux Valley, another guy heading up to SDSU. Benson Kiefer from Rapid City Christian. Number of different athletes in attendance checking out championship Saturday evening.
McGovern commits that foul. That's her second. She'll be replaced by Johnson. We'll be talking about the boys' talent at the various tournaments next week. Again, we got a lot of talent in this state. And there's a nice little hook by Flanagan for the bucket.
What I love to see there with Flanagan, went off 2 feet, she was balanced. She had one earlier this game where she went flying in off 1 foot, just didn't have as nice a body control, and there, that was textbook.
Harrisburg up by 3, and now Dunn blocking foul, no shot. And that'll be Wagner collecting her second personal foul. Check that out again on the replay. Wagner trying to guard her. Contact. I don't know if Wagner was fully set.
Yeah, you want him to be in legal guarding position, and she was not in legal guarding position right there. I think that was a good call by the officials.
Dunn looking inside, has to swing it outside to Altenburg.
Yep, I got a bit of a mismatch. Harrisburg's been pretty locked in on that backside, as we've talked about.
Dunn screaming for it. Now they lob it to her. She gets it. No good. And Hofer comes away with the ball. Merman will let the traffic pass her by, and Now here's Flanagan trying to get into the paint. Has to go outside. Now inside, Lorenzen had it partially blocked.
And Lindsey Worth for Harrisburg. Oh, nice corner. Lindsey Worth from Harrisburg making an appearance here. And another one that hasn't gotten a ton of minutes here these first two games this tournament.
Now Worth, one of the team captains. She is headed off to Notre Dame to study business next year. Technically later this year, but you know what I mean. And there's a shot, no good. And hopefully we'll get some free throws.
Yeah, in Brindley, you could tell at the halftime that, and not that it wasn't coming into the end of the game, but trying to take Altenburg's touches and shots away as much as possible. Harrisburg's done a better job of that here in this third quarter than they did in the first half. And they've provided more help when she tries probing. She's so dynamite, especially going to that strong left hand.
Hofer missed the first one on the year, 71%. Gets that one. She has 7 points. Harrisburg, the lead is 2.
It's a little token full court pressure, but they'll drop back into their man-to-man. Yeah, there's Flanagan right in that gap as Altenburg's trying to drive. Oh,
nice little give and go. Johnson with the finish.
We've seen a couple of the old school give and goes here this evening. The bigs, both Dunn and Lawrenson, have both had great vision, finding cutters, passing ability.
And we'll have a holding foul, and that will be on the Cavaliers, and that will be on Horner, her first. If we get any more old school, we might have that Princeton offense being run here at some time.
Hey, yep. There's ones that are still doing it. Normally not quite as disciplined as old Coach Kirill, but still some concepts that will live on, I'm sure, for eternity in the game of basketball.
Worth checks out of the game for Harrisburg. Young sets are in, and that free throw is missed. Silvernail runs it down in the corner.
It's going to be time for one more possession for Harrisburg if they can finish with a quick rebound.
Altenburg trying to make something happen. Dunn way out on the perimeter. Puts it on the floor, trying to back down. There's nothing there. Dunn posting up again. Here's a 3. No. Dunn with the rebound. She'll throw it outside. Altenburg all the way. Yes. Her first points of the second half.
They got time. I don't know if they see the clock. 4-3.
And Flanagan's going to fire. No, off the window. 29-27. Jefferson comes back to take the lead after they trailed a bit in this third quarter. We'll be back with the fourth quarter after this break on SDPB3.
Lucky for us, life is full of choices, big and small, just as it should be. They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business, Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
Close game through three quarters. Jefferson leading Harrisburg 29-27. Third place on the line here at the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toome. And what a strong finish for Jefferson there to close out that period, because they trailed a good chunk of that third quarter, Nate.
They did, and yeah, I was most impressed with Harrisburg and just getting back going offensively. And for about a game and a half, it had been a struggle in there.
Oh, what a block by Young Setzer. Good start defensively for the Tigers to start this period. Let's see if they can convert on the other end. Lorenzen getting a rest.
Jefferson dropping back now into their zone. They're mixing defenses, trying to keep the Tigers off balance with what they're getting done offensively.
Hofer for three, yes. She's got 10.
You do not want to leave her open. Any type of sunshine or daylight, and that thing's got a great chance of going down.
Swing it back to Johnson. Tries the up and under again. Altenburg is open for three. Yes. 15 for Altenburg.
Harrisburg got caught. They had initially switched that ball screen, and I think Young Setzer was thinking that they were going to switch back on the weak side of the floor, and the ball just found Altenburg.
Hofer is open again. Yes.
This is looking like Thursday all over again, Steve.
4 3-pointers
Fourth
for her.
Fourth one. See if she can get to that six. Six it was on Thursday night.
Harrisburg leads by one. Altenburg wheeling and dealing. No. Rebound underneath to Horner. Trying to put it up, and she'll be fouled. Two free throws coming up.
Taylor Silvernail there, crashing from the weak side, and that's what, when you shoot about 75-80% of the time, that ball's gonna be bouncing to the weak side. Altenburg loaded it from the right wing. Silvernail just gets a touch on it, bounces right to Horner, and she winds up at the foul line.
Missed the free throw, does Horner. 52% on the year. Horner is a sophomore. Lorenzen back into the game. McGovern replaces Silvernail for the Cavaliers. And she got that one to go. 7 points on the night for Horner.
All knotted up. 6 minutes to go. I think we could have predicted that this one was going to be coming down the stretch, possession by possession game.
To the corner, nothing there for Lorenzen. She'll get it back. Merman, see if they're gonna post up Lorenzen. They're gonna let her shoot, no good. Long rebound pulled down by Dunn. She wants to run, Altenburg ahead of the pack. No, but a foul is gonna be called on Lorenzen, and that will be number two on her.
Such a benefit to transition offense when you have a post player like Dunn that's able to snatch a rebound, take one or two bust out dribbles, and then look ahead.
Altenburg at the line, 71% on the season. And she makes that one. You know, we didn't have any free throws at all for either team until the second half. Got them both. She has 17 on the night.
So talented offensively, and there she creates a turnover.
Merman slipped, and Altenburg can't finish. But there's Horner again, and she's gonna be called for traveling.
The thing about Abby Horner, she's one of those players that just always around the basketball. Might not be the most skilled player in the world shooting it or handling it, but she's just always around the basketball. Such great effort. She's got a nose for the ball.
Bounce pass goes to Hofer. Cavaliers up by two. Here's Flanagan, ties the game.
She has such a soft touch, whether it's shooting the ball from 20 feet, whether it's finishing with a floater at the rim.
Under 5 minutes to go, and we're tied. Done, yes. She has eight.
Just too deep of a touch there. Merman gets switched on to Dunn. She's got to battle her off the block or fight around to a front.
And we're going to have a foul, and that is going to be on Horner, and that is our second. Timeout on the court. 4:38 left. Jefferson leads by two in the fourth quarter. This is Class AA Girls Basketball on SDPB 3.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Welcome back to Heritage Court inside the Pentagon here in Sioux Falls. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toome, and we've got a dandy on our hands.
Yeah, been a great back and forth battle thus far. 4.5 to play here. We'll see who makes the most plays down the stretch, and it's been big guns coming to play here with Hofer 13, Flanagan 15, Altenburg 17, Jaden Dunn being a factor inside.
There's a steal by McGovern. But she lost the handle. Merman the other way. Flanagan looking to go across the lane. Plenty of white jerseys there. Got Altenburg in the air, floats it up, too short. But the rebound skitters to the outside, and Horner is going to be fouled by Hofer. And that is her first.
Hofer
team's third, I believe. Yes, it is.
Hofer was hustling for the loose ball, a little late on it. A call for the push. We'll see here. Altenburg and Dunn involved normally. Ball screen action, just like we're seeing right there up top. And then a hard roll, that's what they've gone to a lot.
Horner was open on the perimeter, but that was shut down by the Tiger defense. There's the entry pass, and we're going to have a foul, and that's going to be on Flanagan. That is her third.
You could see Altenburg there doing exactly what we visited about in the first half, taking one hard bounce to the baseline, delivering that bounce pass, forced a foul.
Fourth team foul on Harrisburg. Free throws the rest of the way for Jefferson, but they throw it away right to Merman on the move into the paint. Now here's a three, short. Rebound Flanagan, tried to put it up, trying to fight for the rebound. She's going to try to put it up, swatted away by Dunn. Out of bounds, it goes to Jefferson.
Flanagan tried to tip it up in the air initially, and there Dunn's using her length and such a factor inside, both offensively and defensively.
Altenburg will fire a three, it's off the mark. And it'll miss everything, and it will go to the Tigers. Not like her to miss everything on a shot. That happened really early in the shot clock, too.
Yeah, and that's just, you gotta live, you gotta take, it's a lot more good than it is bad, but when you gotta live with some missed shots there, when you got a player like she is.
Wagner trapped in the corner. Timeout called by Harrisburg. They'll have two left. Four timeouts left for Jefferson at the moment. 3:08 left.
Yeah, Harrisburg, this half, it's been night and day difference in terms of their offensive attack, the confidence that they're getting. And frankly, we talked about this yesterday. Sometimes the game boils down to the ball going in the rim, shooting it with a ton of confidence, and they've done a lot better job of that here this second half. Jefferson, on the other hand, continues to switch up defenses, trying to keep them off balance, and it's going to be a lot of what we've seen, and that's high ball screens from Altenburg, Dunn rolling to the rim and then playing out of it.
Turnovers, 13 for the Cavaliers, 11 for the Tigers. Shooting, 13 of 37 for Harrisburg, 15 of 35 for Jefferson. From three-point land, that's what's kept Harrisburg in the game. They're 7 of 17, but the Cavaliers are 4 of 13 from beyond the arc. Free throws, 3 of 4 for the Cavaliers, 2 of 6 for Harrisburg. Rebounding, plus 1 Harrisburg.
Yeah, as you mentioned, been a pretty even floor game for the most part. You know, turnovers relatively equal, rebounding relatively equal. Shooting splits are a little different, but that's why we have a two-point game on our hands.
Ofer to Flanagan. They play catch. Now here's Lorenzen. Clearing out, goes over Johnson, scoops it up, no good off the window. Dunn again moving into the front court rapidly. Corner on the weak side, way too high off the glass. Johnson tried to save it but stepped on the end line.
I think Lorenzen would have liked to have that one back down here. She knew she had a great matchup with a deep touch. She's got to keep her eyes up on that finish.
Merman lost it, got it back. Jefferson extending that defense. Now here's Lorenzen in the post, puts it up, no good. Merman has to throw it to the outside. Errant pass picked up by Horner. Jump ball, possession arrow Tigers with 2:12 left.
It's good hustle there, tying up the basketball.
Normally Merman would have probably gone back up with that, but with Dunn standing there, it makes you rethink things.
Yeah. Yeah, whether it's blocking shots or whether it's deterrent shots, same outcome.
Another errant pass, and it goes to the Cavaliers. That's a heartbreak for Jefferson because they got it on the alternating possession, but then turn it over. So the next jump ball goes to the Cavaliers. And the next foul on Harrisburg sends Jefferson to the line. But Jefferson holding a few aces here. Corner. That ball hit a foot of a player, and it ends up in the hands of Harrisburg.
It's a big stop, and they got numbers if they can get it ahead.
Merman pulls up, way off the mark, and a rebounding foul. Nope, jump ball. Jump ball will give it to the Cavaliers.
A lot of time here still remaining. Minute 35 left. Harrisburg extending. Sure they'll extend their full court pressure. Play this one out. These are just huge, huge possessions when it's still a one possession game. Jefferson comes down. If they can get a two, get a three, make it that two possession game, and it just, oftentimes it can just sink your sails a little bit defensively. So this is a big possession coming out of the timeout.
Timeout called by Jefferson. They have three remaining. Harrisburg, two timeouts. Only one team foul, by the way, currently on Jefferson. They have fouls to give. Harrisburg, three more turnovers. Rebounding battle even. Jefferson, a few more free throws. Then they've had more opportunities. And the Tigers here have made a few three-pointers on the night. That stat might be reversed because I have Harrisburg down for 5 three-pointers made on the night.
Yeah. I think they've hit 7 of them, I believe, with Ofer 4
seven
and Flanagan
7
two,
of 17 and Cavaliers 4 of 13 on the night. 13 of 40 from the floor for Harrisburg, 15-36 for Jefferson. Scoring drought, 3 minutes 32 seconds for Harrisburg, 3 minutes 14 seconds for the Cavaliers. Next points will be vital.
Yeah, things were rolling pretty smooth offensively for both teams in this, especially in this fourth quarter. until we kind of hit the halfway point.
McGovern has been relatively quiet tonight. Somebody hit the deck hard. That's Hofer. And there's Horner with the drive. No. Horner's still on the floor. And that's going to be out of bounds. And Hofer on the floor. Still yet to get up. Teams will head to their respective benches.
Looks like she's clutching the leg, clutching the knee. You
hate to see that.
Yeah, you hope it's just a contusion or hitting and not something more serious.
Yeah, especially for that young lady, Jaylee Hofer. She is a senior. This fall, she'll be heading to Northern to play soccer, study human performance and fitness. And she's going to check out of the game, and she is not putting any weight at all on that right foot. And she is getting a standing ovation and well-deserved from the crowd here at the Pentagon. Everybody is standing.
Yeah, that's a tough blow for Harrisburg, as Hofer's just been an absolute weapon for them with her ability to shoot the basketball. 4 of 8 from three tonight. 13 points overall. They're going to have to play this last minute and 12 without her presence.
Yep, they're taking her right back to the locker room. They'll have the training staff examine her here at the Pentagon. And you hate to see the senior carried off the court with a minute 12 left. Couldn't see what happened. The action was away from where the ball was. Renson gives way. Van Bockeren has to come into play for Hofer. Flanagan drives, open, lost the handle, and Johnson takes it away. Foul. And I think that's going to be on Harrisburg.
And that'll be free throws for Ashlyn Johnson.
And she has a big smile on her face as Flanagan gets tagged for the foul. That is her fourth. And she is right now probably scoring option number one for Harrisburg, but four fouls, double bonus time. Johnson on the year, 55%.
Yeah, it's just Flanagan. Flanagan's definitely going to have to be the one. They're not getting a whole lot else. Addie Wagner hit the 1-3. Lawrenson 1 of 7 for 2 points, and the rest are coming pretty much from Hofer, who is unfortunately not going to be joining us again.
Check that. They're going to take that foul away from Flanagan and assign that one to Wagner. So that'll be her third. Two free throws here, the double bonus. No good.
So to be a one possession game, regardless of the make or miss here, either down two, down three, still plenty of time.
Iron was kind. You don't necessarily need a three if you're Harrisburg at this point.
No, all options on the table. Quick two, wide open three. Just want to stay aggressive. Found Flanagan.
That's off the mark. And she covers her face.
Yep, so there Harrisburg wants to, going to want to pick up full here. Still have time. Don't need to foul immediately.
And they're going to go foul immediately, and that will be Wagner. Never listed for two fouls. That'll be number three. Well, they did give that last foul to Flanagan. So she does have four. Wagner now with three.
As a Harrisburg fan, this is not who you want to see at the line. Brinley Altenberg, 24, 2 of 2. From the night, shoots the ball at an extremely high level.
Now it's a two-possession game. 71% on the season for the freshman.
Yep.
Oh, those were good-looking free throws.
Pier lefty stroke. Harrisburg's got to try to get something quick.
Defense really being extended, and a blocking foul. That'll be on Horner, but that isn't so bad because that's only their second team foul. They've got two more to give. Now actually works in Jefferson's favor because they can make Harrisburg work for things and then commit a foul. They can burn time. Harrisburg has called the timeout. They have one left.
Yeah. Yeah, you want to force them to make as many passes as you can. The one thing you got to be careful of is where on the court they're taking those fouls. So you want to be able to take them outside the three, outside of an operating area right there, or immediately on that drive. But as soon as they start nearing that paint area, it's tough to take them at that point in time. Then all of a sudden they get up a quick one and the refs giving you a continuation and opportunities for shots or opportunities for an and one.
Looking at some of the action here from the second half. There's Flanagan, that nice little jump hook shot there. Horner through traffic, got a layup there.
Yeah, and Horner's really added an offensive punch that they certainly didn't have last night. And she's just been active, 7 points. Hard downhill drives, shot fakes, six rebounds on the day.
Dunn with 8 points. Altenberg with 19. Johnson with 6. Horner 7. McGovern yet to score in this game. She's been relatively quiet. But she does have 5 rebounds and 2 assists. So Jefferson up by 5. They're holding all the aces at the moment. They have 2 fouls to give.
See what Harrisburg can come up with here. Van Bockeren, nice. Yeah, bring Van Bockeren, who checked in for Jaylee Hofer. Gets downhill, and it does look like Hofer's came out of the locker room and has ice on her ankle, it appears,
yes.
And not the knee, which
That's the first thing you think of is, you know, you don't want it to be an ACL or an MCL.
Yeah. I mean,
an ankle's bad enough, and they're bringing out crutches for her, so.
It is. You hope it can, you know, hopefully it's just a bad sprain or something, and we're talking weeks, and we're not talking months.
Months and surgery.
So.
But what a
all
what
the
a
best
tournament.
To her, yeah.
Yeah, what a tournament that Jaylee Hofer has had. Her night ends with 13 points, and her career ends with 13 points. But what a sensational player she has been on the soccer pitch and on the basketball court. And Northern's getting a good one there, no doubt about it.
For sure. Coming out of the timeout here, Harrisburg wants to be extremely aggressive. 19.5 seconds left. If they get the ball in bounds, unless you got them in a really bad spot, they're probably going to take one immediately on the touch. But if you can, you want to try to work for a turnover or work for a 5-second violation as Jefferson's inbounding.
Shot clock is off. 19 and a half seconds, 3-point game. We've seen teams at this tournament struggle on inbounds plays. And of course, they get it right to Altenberg, and there will be a foul. I think they're going to get Wagner for that one. 2 free throws the other way.
That was the pure Lennox Dupree special right there, where they just go 1-4 high and think that you're going long, and then just hard cut right back to the ball.
Wagner indeed get that foul for the Tigers. That's number 4 on her. 2 free throws coming up. Nothing but net.
Yeah, we've seen some people in this tournament when they've been in those situations put 2 players on one, and honestly with Altenberg, she's so money that you might think about doing that next time.
Got them both. Lead is back to 5. Merman operating in a hurry. Here's Lorenzen, a 3.
Oh,
yes!
Gets it with the clock.
Don't turn out the lights just yet. Now, remember, well, Harrisburg, they're out of timeouts. I think, what, they get a bench warning? And subs coming in.
And that was actually very, very smart because they stopped the clock.
Yeah.
Otherwise, the clock would have just kept on going.
7.2 left. And quick foul right away.
And she gets it again.
And I think Wagner or Flanagan was right there, and whoever it's on, they're done.
Yeah, that
is Wagner.
That was an extremely, extremely heady play. Watch here. I think did they just throw? Yeah, she just threw the ball.
Oh.
And who knows? Hopefully it was purposefully.
Yes.
It certainly looked like a delay of game warning.
So Addie Wagner, the senior, her career is over as she fouls out. Oh, Altenberg. Money and a timeout called by the Cavaliers. They want to talk things over to make sure everybody's together for the final 6.6 seconds.
Yeah, Coach Pruitt's probably talking about if for some chance there is a miss here, that same thing that we visited about in the second game, that foul or defend situation. And this is one where they could potentially take one early.
I think it's two team fouls on Jefferson still. That's what our scoreboard is showing. If that's the case, that works definitely in Jefferson's favor because they got two fouls to give.
Yep. Yeah. And really, it won't probably matter with Brindley Altenberg, but you also kind of get into that deal that you're kind of icing your own shooter a little bit. Harrisburg's out of timeouts and you call one. We'll see.
8 of 8 from the line, all in this quarter for Altenberg.
With none of them even touching the rim.
Merman pressured into the front court. Time winding down. Worth. Flanagan fires a three. It would have counted. And 44-40 is your final score. And for the second year in a row, Jefferson defeats Harrisburg in the third place game. The Cavaliers will end their season third straight year as the third place team at the Class AA girls basketball tournament. What a run the Cavaliers have been on to start things off, as they are the new school in the Sioux Falls metro area.
Yeah, been an impressive early couple of years for the Sioux Falls Jefferson athletic programs overall. A lot of success across the board.
Yeah, they got a football title already, and they've done very well in other sports as well, as the new green and gold school in South Dakota in the big school ranks.
Yeah, it's always, you see this raw emotion of these, especially the seniors, you know, that get done with these games, and it's they spend so much time with these, a lot of them classmates over a number of years, and they get put in this this situation where their careers are ending, and it just kind of spills out of them.
So we're ready to hand out some awards for the third and fourth place teams here at the girls AA basketball tournament. Let's turn it over, Greg Thompson.
Good evening, fans. We'd like to present the awards to the teams that played for third and fourth tonight. To present the awards from the South Dakota High School Activities Association Board of Directors, Danny Walking Eagle and Ryan Rollinger. Assisting with the team awards presentation are representatives from the Activity Association's corporate partners, Sanford Health, Jason Flanagan, from Farmers Union Insurance, Stacy Monger, from South Dakota National Guard, Master Sergeant Reginald Hangman. We'll start tonight with the fourth place, Tigers of Harrisburg. Number one, Maya Johnson. Number two, Addie Wagner. Number three, Bryn Van Bakeren. Number four, Jaylee Hofer. Number 11, Abigail Flanagan. Number 12, Lindsay Worth. Number 14, Sadie Merman. Number 20, McKinley Lorenzen. Number 22, Macy Bryant. Number 30, Jada Mason. Number 33, Leslie Young Setzer. Managers Aubrey Fitzgerald and Aubrey Lang. Assistant coaches Dana Biggie, Brittany Rosberg, Haley Halling, and Mick Zeman. And accepting the award for fourth place, head coach Nick Meyer of the Tigers of Harrisburg. And now let's award third place medals to the Cavaliers of Jefferson. Number one, Aaliyah McGovern. Number two, Ava Silvernail. Number three, Taylor Silvernail. Number four, Peyton Crowell. Number five, Taryn Hieronymus. Number 10, Addison Warnke. Number 11, Aaliyah Johnson. Number 12, Lydia Johnson. Number 13, Abby Horner. Number 14, Ella Miley. Number 50, Torin Nilges. Number 20, Cameron Whiting. Number 21, Jaden Dunn. Number 23, Ashlyn Johnson. Number 24, Brinley Altenberg. Managers, Kayla Newberg, Chloe Johnson, Kaya Polly, Monica Ajith, and Namatori. Assistant coaches, Derek Dunn, Sarah Zirpel, Mark Eisenbride, Ethan Fries, and Paige Beck. And accepting the trophy for third place, Shantiva Pruitt and the Cavaliers of Jefferson. Again, after pictures.
Congratulations to the Cavaliers. Third year in a row, they finish third place here at the Girls AA Basketball Tournament. We'll take a timeout and come back with more. You're watching SDPB3.
As much as you have accomplished, there are times you'd rather not go it alone. While you determine what direction you go, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with community. Go with neighbors. Go with understanding. Go with support.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
I decided to switch my major. I didn't want to do sports anymore, so I decided Southeast Tech would be a good one for me to go. The current instructor is a captain with the Highway Patrol. He had a lot of experience and knowledge about the job. I serve the people just as much as they serve me.
way humans make sense of the world is through stories.
We've got to go ahead and start training to go to Mars.
And lift off.
We pay tribute to all who serve and who have served.
Civilization is precious. Life is precious.
Artists here are making a difference.
I'm trying to seek redemption.
Jefferson wins third place. Nate Kading standing by with the winning coach.
Coach, heck of a win right there. Talk about your guys' defensive effort holding the team like that to 40 points.
Yeah, that's something we try to strive on. And, you know, my girls, we always say we defend, but you actually got to go out and do it. And so I was very proud of them for how they fought. Rebound, Jaden had some huge rebounds at the end of the game, and so did other people. So, again, just proud of that. They never gave up.
The freshman sensation, Brittany Altenberg, just a steadying presence out there. Talk about what she means to this team at such a young age.
Yeah, you know, she's fun to watch and she's fun to coach, and she's somebody who I've seen improve throughout the year, just the confidence overall. You also got to credit her teammates, you know, for trusting her, for getting her involved and playing off of her. And so it was a good team effort, and I'm just blessed that God's given me the opportunity to coach these girls.
No question. Jane Dunn inside, a lot of ball screen, roll action. That was something that you saw probably with some of their coverages.
Yeah, absolutely. And like I said, Jaden does so much. We're going to miss her so much this next year. You know, she rebounds, she sets those screens, she's vocal, she hustles. And so just to have somebody with senior leadership like her, we're really blessed.
Congrats again on the win. Thanks for the time.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Coach Pruitt. Her team wins 44-40. Let's check out some of the highlights from the second half of action. This game was close throughout. Three-pointers were starting to fly in that second half for Harrisburg. Dunn, very strong with the left-handed finish there. There's another three in the air, and that was good by Wagner. There's Horner. She had a big game, coming up with 7 points. And Altenberg, just so smooth for a freshman. This woman is going to be just bad news for the competition. Jaylee Hofer hits a three. She started cooking in the second half with 3 three-pointers. Altenberg had an answer there. And here's Altenberg getting the steal, moving down court, making something happen. Another shot rolls in for Harrisburg. But it wasn't enough. Hofer got hurt late in the game, and Jefferson prevails. Pretty even stats, 3-point shooting edge to Harrisburg, rebounding even, turnovers even, but Jefferson better at the free throw line, more opportunities, and they cashed in 10 of 12. Altenberg, 23 points on the night, the only Cavalier in double figures, 15 for Flanagan, 13 for Hofer, the players in double figures for Harrisburg. Congratulations to Sioux Falls Jefferson. We're going to take a timeout. We'll get you set up for the championship game between O'Gorman and Brandon Valley. More to come here on SDPB3.
Our teams are committed to improving quality of life in our communities. Whether we're planning construction concepts, building a new downtown development, bringing new businesses to our communities, or maintaining your apartment home, we believe everyone deserves a well-built and well-managed place to live and work. This is Lloyd.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do, and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
sometimes having 15 of something is great. Like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Well, we've just got one game left in the basketball season for Class AA girls. It features Brandon Valley taking on O'Gorman, along with Nate Kading. I'm Steve Toome. Great to have you here on a Saturday night at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Congratulations to Jefferson. They take third place. Brandon Valley, Mike Zurr is their head coach. This team has been on quite a roll. They lost to O'Gorman big, but that was the first game of the year. They have wins over Pierre, Stevens, and Harrisburg. They beat Brookings to get here. Took care of business in fine fashion against Spearfish and Harrisburg in the first two rounds. And really, since the calendar turned to 2024, this team's been just on a roll.
Coach Zier mentioned it last night. He's been so thrilled with the development and improvement of his team throughout the course of the season. They had a few early setbacks early on the season, playing some younger kids, getting them some varsity experience. But as you mentioned, over this last month and a half, 2 months of the season, they've been playing as good as anybody in the entire state.
Paget, Kellenberger, Giever, Hoff, Deckard, that's your starting lineup. Two seniors, a junior, and a couple of sophomores. And they go three deep on the bench with Amanda Lease, Reese Cosden, and Gracie Salter getting a ton of playing time. There's Giever getting a bucket there right before the buzzer sounded to end the period. She is a force in the paint. But it's Olivia Paget, number 32, that has done so much damage to the opponent. She can shoot from the outside, play inside, create off the dribble. As you see the Lynx celebrating last night as they took care of business against Harrisburg, 51-36. This is a dangerous, dangerous team.
Yeah, Paget is just, she's the catalyst with everything that they're trying to get done offensively, but they also have Madison Giever inside that is just a legitimate post presence that they can throw the ball into her, collapse the defense, play inside out, and they've been really, really scrappy defensively, holding teams in their two games here this tournament to 25% from the floor and 32% from the floor. It's been a huge reason why they're here with us here tonight.
Down the stretch, their only loss was to Mitchell, 62-56. That was at Mitchell on February 20th. Other than that, they have been rolling through opponents. We'll take a timeout. We'll come back and we'll meet the unbeaten Lady Knights of O'Gorman back in a moment here from the Sanford Pentagon. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on SDPB3.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
At Bank West, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. Building a future filled with opportunity. Bank West.
Established in 1986, the Great Plains Tribal Leaders Health Board represents 18 tribal communities located in South Dakota, North Dakota, Nebraska, and Iowa. Our vision is that all tribal nations, communities, and citizens achieve optimal wellness through the embrace of traditional cultural values and innovative and holistic healing practices, strengthened by tribal sovereignty. For more information on our grant programs, health services, and career opportunities, visit our website at greatplainstribalhealth.org.
This is the PBS app. It's ready for you whenever you want full episodes of your favorites, perhaps a little history, or the real story, shows with heart, or the latest news and docs. Even stream your local station live. It's all there waiting for you. So download the PBS app now for everything you love and a whole lot more to explore. Stream anytime, anywhere with the PBS app.
We are back at Heritage Court inside the Pentagon. Stands pretty darn full here. Student section's pretty darn full. But a great atmosphere here for the final game of the regular season, and all the marbles on the line. O'Gorman taking on Brandon Valley along with Nate Kading. I'm Steve Toome. Let's meet the undefeated Sioux Falls O'Gorman Lady Knights. Kent Colesrud is their coach. Number 9 on the all-time wins list. They had a perfect regular season, including wins over Brandon Valley. Now, mind you, that was the first game of the year, 65-28. Harrisburg, Mitchell, other opponents. O'Gorman has just been rolling through opponents. They beat Roosevelt quite handily in the SODAC 16. But that first game of the state tournament, Nate, I think that was a wake-up call.
Yeah, no question. Rapid City Stevens tested them, pushed it into overtime, just couldn't get over the hump. It is really super impressive that they're sitting here at this point right now. The level of consistency that it takes throughout the ups and downs of a season, it's unbelievable. And here tonight, they look to try to cap everything off with one final victory.
Lucy Moore, Molly Abdush, Sydney Turvine, Julia Eggert, Owang Okoy, three seniors, a junior, and a sophomore in that starting lineup. They'll go with Peyton Peterson, Ruby Moore, and Claire Benson coming off the bench. This team is one of the best defensive teams I think I've ever seen.
They absolutely fuel their offense with everything they get done defensively. So far in the first two games, this tournament against Jefferson caused 22 turnovers. Rapid City Stevens caused 20 turnovers. They just seem like they're all over the place. They're gonna mix their full court pressure with their half court pressure, and they're just an absolute bear to try to score against and play against.
And they turn those turnovers into points to the O'Gorman Lady Knights, as you see them punching their ticket into the championship game last night. That backcourt of Moore and Abdush, both going off to play college basketball. Abdush signed at South Dakota State, Moore at Northern State. That's one of the best backcourts I think I've ever seen at the high school level, because they're interchangeable. Both can play the shooting guard and the point guard.
Yeah, Coach Colesrud said it last night. They have such great connectivity with one another and synergy with one another. As you mentioned, one can play on the ball, one can play off the ball. They can go vice versa with it. It's a two-headed monster that you just don't often see with two girls that are not only super skilled with everything that they're gonna get done, but they'll play both ends of the floor. They'll guard, they're tough, they can make shots, they can drive it. Just all around really, really talented and good players for the Knights.
Lynx, they have a couple of titles, 2019 and 2011. Three championships for O'Gorman. 95, they won a championship. 2017 and 2022, they claimed the championship. In 2001, 2006, 2011, 2015, they were runner-up. Last year, O'Gorman fifth place here at the state tournament. They have 15 straight tournament appearances, and they are seeking that unbeaten season. What do they have to do to get that last W against Brandon Valley?
Yeah, the things to really look for tonight, the rebounding battle is going to play a huge factor in this game. Brandon Valley's came on the positive end of that so far in their two games this season. The crazy thing about O'Gorman is there's times where they can actually be out-rebounded, but they create so many turnovers and they cause so many missed shots that it ends up making up for that, and certainly the other team has more rebounding opportunities that way. But focus on the rebounding battle. Brandon Valley needs to take care of the basketball, and then both teams are going to be playing a lot of zone, trapping, scrappy defense, and who can get comfortable against that, who can find rhythm against that. Those three things are going to be a large part of tonight's game.
Well, we've had a look at the teams. The fans have packed the Pentagon here in Sioux Falls. All blue for the cheering section for O'Gorman. The black Ironclad fans to our right for Brandon Valley. We're ready for the pregame introductions and pregame ceremonies. Our public address announcer is Mr. Greg Thompson. Let's turn things over to him.
Good evening, basketball fans. The South Dakota High School Activities Association welcomes you to the championship game of the State Girls AA High School Basketball Tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activities Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you'll enjoy the game and support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. This game features the Lynx of Brandon Valley. And the Lady Knights of O'Gorman.
Time. It represents the past, the present, and the future, all at the same time. When you hear that it's state tournament time, what do you think about? Do you think about moments in the past? Maybe you think about one of the previous state championship teams. Or maybe it was the time your team came up just short and you can't shake it from your memory. When you hear it's state tournament time, do you think about the present? Do you think about the Brandon Valley Lynx? Or do you think about the Sioux Falls O'Gorman Knights? Or maybe when you hear it's state tournament time, your mind goes to the future. And time will tell who is left standing and celebrating with this trophy and leaving with these nets. Time can represent many things, but this moment right here, this is your time.
And now let's meet the starters for tonight's game in alternating fashion. For the Lynx at guard, a 5'7 sophomore, number 2, Ava Kellenberger. For the Lady Knights at guard, a 5'7 senior, number 11, Lucy Moore. For the Lynx at guard, a 5'6 senior, number 3, Kennedy Deckard. For the Lady Knights at guard, a 5'8 senior, number 15, Molly Abdush. For the Lynx at forward, a 6'1 junior, number 5, Madison Giever. For the Lady Knights at guard, a 5'10 sophomore, number 30, Sydney Turveen. For the Lynx at forward, a 5'9 senior, number 24, Paisley Hoff. For the Lady Knights at forward, a 5'10 junior, number 31, Julia Eggert. For the Lynx at guard, a 5'7 sophomore, number 32, Olivia Padgett. For the Lady Knights at center, a 6'2 senior, number 35, Awang Akoy. The Lynx are led by Mike Zurr, assistant coaches Jeff Lochner, Katie Paula, Maggie Dady, and Emma Turvey. The Lady Knights are led by Kent Colesrud, assistant coaches Barry Matthews, Crystal Richter, Dan Hughes, and Kristen Rydell. Your officials for this game, Brian Wedham, Derek Berg, and Royce Wurzler.
teams are on the court. Time to hit the lights and play for a championship. The Lynx in the road black uniforms, the red numbers and letters. The home whites for O'Gorman with the blue numbers and letters. Along with Nate Keating, I'm Steve Toome. The ball's in the air. It's controlled by the Knights.
Let's see who can get off to an early hot start. And as usual, you're going to see Brandon Valley in their extended 2-3. Those guards are super active out in passing lanes.
And here's a drive by Tervine. Okoye is tied up and will get two free throws. Quick foul right away. I believe that's on Kellenberger. And it is the first foul game. It is on Kellenberger, and Okoye at the line. The lefty puts it up and in.
And Molly Abdush's vision against this zone. There she finds a skip pass to a hard attack by Sydney Tervine. Going to be an important part of their zone attack.
Rebound comes down to Moore. And traveling the call.
You just see the toughness and tenacity, though, of Moore coming up with the board against a much bigger defender.
Dangerous pass tipped away by Tervine. And out of bounds to the Lynx. O'Gorman in that third quarter last night just made it a nightmare for Jefferson to try to even get the ball across the timeline. Padgett on the move. There's the open shooter in the corner. No. Giever had her hands on the rebound, but it was tipped away from her. It'll stay with the Lynx.
It's a good find. Kennedy Decker certainly capable of knocking down threes. Hit one of them last night.
Giever had it, lost it, got it back and scores.
Yeah, and Giever just provides them such an interior post presence. They're gonna look at her against that zone.
Shot no good, and there is Eggert. Her shot was tipped. It hit the support. Last touch by a Lynx player. It'll stay with O'Gorman.
I think they're going to talk about the shot clock here, whether that hit the rim or because they reset it initially.
Officials will talk it over here. 7:01 left, just underway. Championship game, Class AA girls basketball tournament. Moore to trigger it in. Abdush. Guarded by Kellenberger along that wing. And the ball's loose on the floor. There's a pile up court. Jump ball, possession arrow, Lynx.
It's gonna be challenging tonight. You gotta use your dribble with a purpose. There, Eggert tries to split two defenders, and you need to be efficient with your bounce against both of these defenses.
Pass goes ahead to Decker. She'll play at Northern. That's where she's planning on continuing her career. Padgett into the lane, scoops it up short, gets her own rebound. Partially blocked. Into the hands of the Knights. Moore out of the pack. Chased by Padgett. And now Abdush will settle things down.
Now O'Gorman's going to push the ball at every single opportunity. There's Sydney Tervine.
McCoy got a rebound, jump ball. And the possession arrow favors the Lady Knights. Fast pace to start this game.
Early activity by Wang Okoye. Blocks a shot on one end, creates a second chance. Ends up getting that dump off, going 1-for-2 from the foul line.
Tervine, step back, jumper, no. Rebound, Giever comes down with it. Moore fighting her for it. Now Tervine makes a play. Whistle, jump ball, possession arrow, Lynx. No pass will be easy tonight.
Electric atmosphere. Both teams just, they understand what's at stake.
And they'll throw it in the front course to Giever. Now back to Padgett. She'll work on the left side. Oh, dangerous pass.
Yeah, their anticipation out on the perimeter with the Lady Knights is something special.
Giever had it and lost it. Tervine ends up with the ball. Moore hands off to Abdush. She'll run things. Okoye steps out. Tervine swings it around. Eggert, the mid-range J. No. And it's tipped out of bounds, and it goes to the Lady Knights.
Yeah, McCoy gets another hand on it. And you're seeing right now, offensively, from O'Gorman, they're moving the ball sharply, moving the ball crisply, something that hasn't happened against this Brandon Valley defense. They just haven't converted at a high level thus far. As I say that.
Chased down by Abdouche, but the layup, no! Rebound, yes! Kellenberger! Four-one, good start for the Lynx. That shot blocked and a foul. And that's going to be on Kellenberger. And that will be her second foul quickly, and that's going to get Amanda Lease to the scorer's table.
Yeah, there's going to be gaps to attack as the perimeter, and we've talked about this a few different times, their perimeter defenders will extend out. There, Kellenberger tries to come back with a rear view contest, just gets a little piece of the arm.
Kellenberger averages 8.5 points, 3.5 rebounds a game. Got them both.
Yeah, no secret to scoring punch. Obviously, Lucy Moore, Molly Abdouche. It's been those two that have provided big games throughout the entire season, including this tournament. 17 and 19 last night, 18 and 19 the night prior.
Padgett in the backcourt. It's tipped and stolen. Eggert scores.
Eggert has such great length at the point of their press.
Padgett through traffic. Pass ahead. Giever blocked by McCoy out of bounds. Timeout on the court. 5-4. O'Gorman on top. Back in a moment right here on SDPB3, home for the girls' AA basketball tournament.
You live life on the move. While you determine what direction that may be, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with values. Go with friends. Go with support. Go with convenience.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
An electric atmosphere here inside the Pentagon. We're off to a fast start in our championship game. Class AA girls, O'Gorman up 5-4 after the block shot. Lynx play it in from under the basket. They go inside and it's tapped away.
Yeah, O'Gorman setting up just in their usual half court zone. There, Brandon Valley tries sneaking in. Padgett tries sneaking in, almost gets a easy deuce.
Salter with the ball. She just checked in. And there's Lease with the ball.
Yeah, Brandon Valley's brings solid depth. Amanda Lease, Condon, Salter have all played different roles for them throughout the season and in this tournament.
Five on the shot clock. Here's Padgett driving, puts it up. And it's a shot clock violation. Didn't hit the rim. Turnover, Lynx.
And Lucy Moore runs Padgett off the three-point line, still recovers back and contests that pull-up jumper. That's the type of multiple efforts that you see from this Lady Knights team. It's what makes them the best defensive team in the state.
And one of the best defensive teams that we've seen in a while.
Correct.
And who says kids don't play defense anymore?
Yeah, both these teams and coaching staffs and fans would disagree.
15 on the shot clock. O'Gorman being patient. Here's the open shooter. It's Moore from the corner. No. And Salter up high for the rebound. Outlet, Abdush tips it away. You've got to be careful. You know 15 and 11 are out there. Abdush, the all-time career steals leader for O'Gorman, number two on the all-time scoring list.
And which makes them a little unique that they extend right into their full court pressure regardless of whether it's a make or a miss. And you just oftentimes don't see this. Oftentimes off a make, teams are going to get in it. Off a miss, they're going to sprint back and play in their half court. Unique style for the Lady Knights.
Peyton Peterson, number 10, picks up the foul. A reserve in for O'Gorman. It's the first team foul. And here comes Ruby Moore to the scorer's table. And she'll replace Eggert. So a little quicker lineup in there now for O'Gorman.
Yeah, the freshman getting the taste of the first state championship action.
Lease with the ball. Back to Padgett. They play catch. Trying to get Salter. They lob it into her. There's the open shooter. Condon can't pull the trigger. Gives it away to Lease. And then there's Salter. Up, no good. Foul. Kent Kozu can't believe it. And that's McCoy, her first, team second.
When you get those situations, when you go up with your inside hand a lot of the time, like Salter did, majority of the time those officials are going to let that go, even if there's a little bit of contact. Just kind of an awkward finish. That's why you really want to stress finishing away from that defense with that outside hand.
Hoff out. Deckard back in for the Lynx. Missed them both. Okoye up high for the rebound. Abdush.
And Abdush just starts their entire pace.
Oh, but she turns it over. Outlet. Padgett catches up. Taken away by Moore. Thrown out of bounds. Great transition defense by Lucy Moore.
Yeah, uncharacteristic turnover from Abdush there. She's normally playing under control. She can play really fast, but still under control. Special guard.
Get it into Deckert. Kennedy, her father, former head coach Brent Deckert. Basketball in her blood, no doubt.
Yeah, no question about that. Brandon Valley just feel like they're in theirs. Yes.
Padgett slicing through the defense.
Good little Salter comes up with it. Just gets enough of that defender. A little rub screen.
Her first points of the night. 15 in the first game. 23 last night for Padgett. Moore. Quick passing by O'Gorman. Moore turnaround free throw line jumper is good. Her first field goal of the night. She's got 4 points.
They send the guard to the high post. Much more comfortable turning, facing, and knocking that down.
Padgett through the defense again. She hits the deck and a foul is going to be called on O'Gorman.
Has such a quick step off that catch and go. Constantly in attack mode. Loves attacking with that left hand even though she's a righty.
Ruby Moore with the foul, her first, team's third. 2 minutes to go, first quarter. It's been a dandy so far. Condon has provided stellar defense throughout this tournament for the Lynx. She handles the ball now.
And the thing with Deckard checking or back in the game here, she's comfortable being a three-point threat, you know. And Brandon, I love the fact that they're attacking the paint, regardless of whether it's zone or man, but number three just provides them that outside threat, constantly ready to shoot.
Lease tapped it out of bounds, and we get the basketball back, and here we go. Moore handles it. Chased by Condon. Now Abdush will run the show. There's the double team. Moore gets away. Now back door. Turveen counted on the foul.
Sydney Turveen muscles that one up there. The possession was looking precarious early on as Abdush dribbles to the sideline and is trapped and able to get two passes out of it. Ends with an and one.
Lease with the foul, her first, team's third. The old-fashioned three-point play for Tervine. She is a sophomore. Across the timeline is Salter. Now Deckard whips a pass down low. Counting in the foul for the Lynx. Condon scores.
And those are the type of possessions that have been hard to come by throughout this entire year against Sioux Falls O'Gorman, where they make you, or Brandon Valley right there, made them pay for their aggressiveness, made them pay for their full court defense. Zip the pass up the sideline, one more underneath.
Lucy Moore with the foul, her first, and that one will fall for Condon. 3 points in the game. Brandon Valley down by one. O'Gorman on the attack, coming up on the 1 minute mark.
Been a back and forth ball game thus far.
Tervine, and a jump ball call, possession arrow, O'Gorman.
21 on the shot clock.
Plenty of time for the Lady Knights.
Abdush right now.
Oh,
only one shot. Only one shot throughout this first quarter thus far.
Bounce pass. Moore scoops it up and draws a foul. Two free throws coming up. Salter with her first, team's fourth. Moore, yeah. 81% on the year.
And there's not much difference with Salter in that back line than there is with Giver. She's still a rim protector, a presence inside, good length, decent athleticism, decent size.
Yep. And the more minutes Salter plays, that makes Giver have fresher legs.
Yeah, she's been out here since about the media timeout, but we expect to see her right away in the beginning of the second. They got there at this point of the season, those rotations are pretty well set with coaching staffs. They know exactly what they're doing, unless there's foul trouble or an injury.
Salter down the lane, off the window, too strong. There's Tervine for a rebound. Shot clock is off. Moore collects it. Let's see if she'll back it out. Double teamed, and Abdush snatches that pass. Looked like it was heading right for us. Three on the way, no. Rebound, Salter. 7 seconds left, they've got some time. Padgett. And she's fouled with 0.8 seconds left. But on the floor, not in the act of shooting.
One guy's, yeah, the baseline's putting two fingers up and.
Was it the 15 foul? It is, so it's going to be free throws nonetheless. And they're going to tag Ruby Moore for that foul, so that is the 15 foul, double bonus time. On the year, the sophomore, 81%. Hoff in, Salter's going to catch an extra few seconds on the bench. She played a very solid first quarter for Brandon Valley. Lynx with the lead. And we're done with one. Brandon Valley 11, O'Gorman 10. Back with the second quarter of the Class AA Girls Championship game after this 1 minute break right here on SDPB 3.
You've worked hard to build your business, your reputation, your success. Your financial partner should be committed to digging in to drive your vision forward. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there, we'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live, where you work. Community is being there for each other. Lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
This game so far, everything we expected it to be. High octane, tough defense, big plays being made on both sides. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toome. We're ready for the second quarter of our girls AA championship basketball game. Brandon Valley up 11 to 10.
Brandon Valley right now, 4 of 12 from the floor, 33%. O'Gorman, 3 of 11, 27%. As you said, both against stingy defenses.
There's a three. Good! Kennedy Decker!
It's a great overload. Coach Sarah, they pin her down, send that shooter out to the corner. Kennedy Decker knocks it down.
Timeout called, I believe. Or do we have a foul?
I think they got a foul right there. A little bit too aggressive in the trap.
I think that one is going to be on Condon. It is her first. Remember, team fouls reset after every period.
Condon just provides such a defensive presence for them, and ball pressure. And
Moore floats it up, and the rebound to Padgett. She's looking to run. Can't get to the basket. Throws it outside to Decker. Padgett so quick with that first step. That one short. Tipped around a couple of times into the hands of Abdouche. Oh, she lost the handle. Throws it ahead to Tervine.
Yeah, cross-court passes in against either of these teams are a dangerous thing. That one gets through.
Yeah, hold your breath every time the ball's in the air for more than 10 feet. Abdouche, three.
Yeah,
yes.
Abdouche finally gets going.
Her first points of the night.
Neither team had hit a three in that first quarter. They both come out here, knock one down each.
Here's Giever back into the game. Now Hoff down the lane, the open shooter. Can't pull the trigger. That was Deckert. Padgett in trouble outside to Deckert. Still plenty of time, 15 on the shot clock. Giever faces up, yes.
Giever with a soft touch, high post flash. McCoy was gonna give it to her.
And there's Condon with the foul as Abdouche setting up court. Condon, her second. Team's second. And that's gonna get, I believe, that's Kellenberger. Yep, she's at the scorer's table. She had to exit the game early with two quick fouls. She's back in.
Yeah, you've seen both teams right now. Lucy Moore hit the one high post jumper. Madison Giever right there. Middle of the zone's gonna be open. Just tough to consistently make enough of those to beat somebody. Normally you're playing through that high post and finding somebody else.
McCoy. And she traveled. Turnover for the Lady Knights. Student sections both on their feet. Here's the high pass, but it's over Deckert and hit one of the laptops. One of the photographers, I think, over here to our left. Right over the head of our colleague John Gaskins, who's been in kind of in the line of fire several times over the weekend.
Yeah. That's the fourth turnover for Brandon Valley. O'Gorman's got five already.
Oh, but a play
there's
by Evers.
Five.
Abdouche, yes, that's a three. Credit Eckert, she missed the shot, got too far under the basket, but then made a steal and set up Abdouche for the tray. We're tied at 16. Padgett lost the handle, but got it back.
Such a weapon.
Shot up and
in. Kellenberger comes in, gets the friendly bounce.
Moore and Abdouche play catch out on the perimeter. Now Tervine steps outside, but they'll go to Eggert in the corner. Trying to get around Deckert. Cannot do so. Tervine fires a three, in and out. And a rebounding foul on the Lady Knights. And that will be. Get more, but we got a timeout on the court. We'll step away for a moment here. You're watching Class AA Girls Basketball. You're watching SDPB 3.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
Get a look at the Brandon Valley cheering section there. 18-16, the Lynx on top. 5 minutes to go until halftime, along with Nate Kading. I'm Steve Tube. Great to have you along for the ride on a Saturday night. The championship on the line.
We pretty much got about standing room only in here right now, Steve. It is a packed house.
Just the way we like it. Yeah. Salter back into the game.
These are the environments and the games that you dream about as you're working as a young kid and throughout the entire year.
As a fan, you love it. As an announcer, I love it. It's great to have a full house and a close game, and that's what we've got as Padgett works at the head of the lane. Lease back in, back to Padgett. Can't make anything happen over there.
Shot clock under 10.
High post, Salter. She'll throw it up and in and out. McCoy grabbed that rebound. Decent look there for Salter.
Yeah.
Tipped out of bounds.
Yeah, the zone attacks have been a bit contrasting on both sides, whereas Brandon Valley's only attempted 2 threes. O'Gorman's actually attempted 6 threes. And Brandon Valley's just really being relentless, whether it's a post touch, whether it's putting pressure on the paint with their bounce right now.
McCoy squares up, no. Salter up high for the rebound. She'll give way up court. Kellenberger now to Lease. Lease down the lane. And that one was blocked. And it's saved. Oh, what a play by Peterson to Abdouche.
And they're so dangerous in transition like this.
Eggert to McCoy. Lease tried to come in there. McCoy hit the deck. No foul called. It'll be O'Gorman basketball. Condon in, Kellenberger out. Here comes a sub in. It's Ruby Moore to replace Tervine for the Lady Knights. 5 turnovers for both teams.
Yeah, trying understanding. There's a little pin down for Ruby Moore.
Oh, Peterson almost had the ball taken away from her, but there's a foul on the Lynx. If it's on Condon, that's her third. And she will have to check out.
Yeah, this is these players are, it's their third game in 3 days, but the adrenaline's flowing, and these coaches, they're going to play the rotations that they have, and you're seeing it right now. O'Gorman going 7 deep, Brandon Valley going 8 deep.
Miscommunication there, the Lady Knights turn it over. Scoring drought over 2 minutes now for O'Gorman.
Little uncharacteristic for the Lady Knights to already have 6 turnovers in this game.
Lease thought about the three along the baseline, had it blocked by O'Koy, out of bounds. It'll stay with Brandon Valley, 20 on the shot clock.
And O'Koy's always gonna be filling over, and that's with Brandon Valley with their attacking ability into the paint that they've shown so far here tonight. They just got to know that O'Koy's going to be a factor.
Oh, what a great fake by Kellenberger. In and out. Salter fighting for the rebound. Bounce pass to the outside. Padgett will reset. Under 3 minutes to go. Dangerous pass into the paint. Jump ball. Possession arrow, O'Gorman.
Abdouche just gets a piece of that one. Causes that tied up basketball. Both teams right now on 2.5 minute scoring droughts. We haven't seen a bucket for a while.
Here's Ruby Moore up top. Abdush gets it. Moore, turnaround. Nice shot by the freshman.
It's a great left shoulder turnaround by Ruby Moore.
Now Salter down the lane. Oh, hit the side of the backboard. They'll keep playing. Now Padgett. Lease back to Padgett. Lease drives. Blocked by Okoye. Lease tips it away. Who's got it? It's going to be Salter.
One Here's more pass to Paisley Hoff. Just a little strong, but Salter.
And we're going to have a jump ball, I believe. And the possession arrow favors the Lynx. Boy, Salter wanted that one back.
Yeah, Okoye is just being such a factor right now. She just anchors and has such great length. Going to Southwest Minnesota State to continue on her career after tonight.
Bounce pass, Hoff, down low, Padgett, in traffic, block, foul.
That's Okoye's second. Mm-hmm. Just had those arms come down rather than staying completely vertical.
Padgett has 5 points. That breaks a long scoring drought. Over 3.5 minutes for Brandon Valley. Okoye out, Eggert in for the Lady Knights. Got them both. Here comes Lucy Moore into the game. Peterson gets a break. Salter checks out in favor of Giever for the Lynx. No made field goals in the last 3.5 minutes for Brandon Valley. They'll take those free throws. Oh, pass off the mark, and Lease commits a foul.
It's only the fourth on Brandon Valley, so it'll just be a side out over here. And one of the things with O'Gorman's attack right now that can be different than some, they're flashing guards into the middle of the floor, people that are comfortable with their passing ability, comfortable turning and shooting, even if they got to handle it for a bounce or two out of there, which is a precarious thing with bodies around, but especially that passing ability inside is just so important. And there you see Sydney Treveen flashing. Finds Moore.
Big three for Lucy Moore. O'Gorman reclaims the lead. Less than 1.5 minutes to go. Hoff gives way to Decker. Giever trying to muscle her way inside. Offensive foul, no bucket. Let's look at it again.
Yeah, bang, bang call. Hardest call in basketball. Block charge. Block charge. She was just trying to power that up through the left shoulder. And
Treveen open in the middle of the lane and scores. She has 5. Coming up on the 1 minute mark. Deckard with the ball. Giever along the baseline, shot up and good by Hoff. Hoff with her first points. High post, Eggert block. Oh, they had a runner, but Giever didn't see her. Deckard fakes the three, drives along the baseline, tipped out of her hands. 3 seconds difference between shot clock and game clock. Here comes a sub to the scorer's table for the Lady Knights. Moore checks out in favor of number 10, Peyton Peterson. See if the Lynx will attack or maybe wind some time off the clock. Giever, turn around, no. Treveen the rebound, shot clock is off. O'Gorman with the 3-point lead. They move it quickly up court. Treveen. See if they'll find Abdush. They will, and she will back it out with 10 seconds left. Against the zone, high post. Cross-court pass, Peterson, 3 seconds left. Moore will let it fly, no! 23-22, O'Gorman leads at the break. You can't get any better than what we've had here in this first half of basketball with O'Gorman on top by one at the break. Let's send it over to Nate Kading.
Coach, as you would expect, low scoring affair with how good these two teams are defensively. What are your thoughts on your offensive attack right now?
Yeah, we just got to do a better job of attacking that paint. You know, they're really pushing us out of things, and just they're getting in passing lanes and being disruptive. And we got to play a little stronger, a little bit more physical, attack a little bit more. I thought the last two or three minutes there, we kind of found those gaps at the high post, you know, and able to attack from there. So we're in good shape. We just got to be the aggressor on offense.
Yeah, thanks for your time, Coach. Best of luck this second half.
All right, thank you, Nate. It's a nail biter here, folks. We'll take a timeout. We'll have the Spirit of Six and the Spirit of Sioux Awards when we come back from this break right here on SDPB3.
We hope you're a fan of stories about heroes, because we'd like you to meet a few of ours. These folks keep our communities moving forward. They're dedicated to being here for you, navigating change, keeping you secure, and offering a helping hand to those who need it. Heroes come from many walks. Ours are here to walk with you. Go with trust. Go with people. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
First Dakota is here for the shared community experiences, the competition, long-standing rivalries, the players and coaches, seeing friends again, and cheering on our favorite teams. It's what makes life great here, and First Dakota is here for it.
We're all going somewhere, going higher, faster, farther, going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring, keep making memories, keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
All right, we're back here at halftime. O'Gorman up by one. Let's hand out some awards. Let's send it over to Greg Thompson.
Ladies and gentlemen, we direct your attention to the center of the floor for the award that is known as the Spirit of Six. The Spirit of Six Award was created by the South Dakota Peace Officers Association as a memorial for the six Rapid City cheerleaders who lost their lives in an airplane accident while returning from the 1968 Boys State Basketball Tournament. In 1977, the Peace Officers Auxiliary expanded the recognition to include the girls' basketball tournaments. As reported by the Rapid City Journal, the spirit epitomized by the Rapid City cheerleaders was best expressed by an inscription on a picture from one cheerleader to another. The inscription read, "This year has been quite a challenge for everyone. You've got the qualities that a good cheerleader needs. I sure hope that we go to state basketball, because that is definitely one of the better sides of cheerleading. Be happy and enjoy this year with all the memories." The award is based on the cheerleaders' abilities displayed in the areas of crowd control,
sportsmanship, spirit, dress, and behavior on and off the court. Here tonight to represent the auxiliary and present the award is Kathy Meyer, president of the South Dakota Peace Officers Auxiliary. And now the moment we've all been waiting for. The cheer squad receiving this year's Spirit of Six trophy for the girls state AA basketball tournament is the Rapid City Stevens Raiders. The Rapid City Stevens cheerleading roster: Grace Antonson, Kate Terry, Mattia Dubray, JC Thompson, Sydney Hawk, Sadie Morgan, Taylor Larson, Olivia Roberts, Lexi Sobey, and Annika Steele, and their coaches Jennifer Agano and Jamie Exner. Ladies and gentlemen, the Raiders from Stevens. All right, all the other squads, go out and give them some love.
Congratulations to Rapid City Stevens. They collect the Spirit of Six Award. And for those cheerleader squads, outside of the cheer and dance championships, that's about the best thing to collecting a state championship as well. Congratulations to those young lady and to the cheer squad advisors from Rapid City Stevens. We will have the Spirit of Sioux handed out here in just a couple of moments. The teams will have to come out of the locker room and get settled in, as then Randy Soma from the High School Activities Association will lead the representatives from the association handing out that award. And the Spirit of Sioux Award will be handed out momentarily here. The squad's still making their way onto the court. Sioux Falls O'Gorman coming out right now. While we have just a moment here, I'll quickly run down a few stats. Shooting stats: 36% for O'Gorman, 31% for Brandon Valley in that first half. Turnovers relatively even at 7-6. One more for Brandon Valley. Rebounds plus 6 for Brandon Valley. From three-point land, 3 of 8 for O'Gorman, 1 of 3 for Brandon Valley. From the free throw line, 5 of 7 for Brandon Valley, 4 of 7 for O'Gorman. You can see the team stats there. It has just been an even up contest. 7 for Moore, 6 for Abdouche leading the way for the O'Gorman Lady Knights. 6 points for Padgett leading the way for Brandon Valley, with 4 each for Kellenberger and for Madison Giever. Those are the top scorers. And we have the squads coming out onto the court. And in a moment, we'll turn things over back to Mr. Greg Thompson, and he will hand out, or he will announce our winner of the Spirit of Sioux. Let's send it over to Greg as we are about ready to go.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, we want to once more again direct your attention to the center of the floor for this presentation of the Spirit of Sioux Award. The Spirit of Sioux Award was created as a memorial for Sue Ann Big Crow. She was best known for her accomplishments on the basketball court, but academic achievement and community involvement were equally important to her. The Spirit of Sioux Award is given to an outstanding high school athlete participating at this tournament who not only shares Sioux Ann's dreams and drive for academic and athletic excellence, but also strives to make life better for others through community service. The player is judged in the categories of outstanding athletic ability, leadership, character, sportsmanship, and grade point average. The beautiful colors of the quilt are symbolic of the four races of people. Sue Ann had a dream that all races could complement each other and live in harmony, thus making the world as beautiful as a quilt we award tonight. Presenting the award tonight from the South Dakota High School Athletic Association, Randy Soma, and Dawn Marie Johnson from the Sioux Falls School Board. Dawn Marie Johnson is the first Native American woman to serve on the Sioux Falls School Board. And ladies and gentlemen, it's that time. This year's Spirit of Sioux Award recipient, from Mitchell, Sawyer Stabner. Ladies and gentlemen, Sawyer Stabner.
Congratulations to Sawyer Stabner from Mitchell High School. She wins the Spirit of Sioux Award. We've got to get a few more pictures with her. Congratulations to that young lady. Let's take a timeout. We'll come back with more here from halftime, the girls AA basketball tournament championship game. You're watching SDPB3.
It's time to focus on you. Healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
Oh my goodness.
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour, you know, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and, you know.
Menacing, menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental, so they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal.
All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do, and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
O'Gorman up by one here at the break. Nate Kading standing by with the Brandon Valley coach.
It's not often do you see the type of pressure that O'Gorman brings. What have you liked about your attack? And then what would you like to see differently against this pressure?
I thought we've handled it really well. Kind of got settled into the game pretty quick.
you know, maybe one or two, I mean, I think maybe two turnovers against the pressure itself, and just got to continue to play with our own pace. You know, we do that stuff every day in practice, you know, going against ourselves, and it's a little bit different structure, but it's still pressure, and, you know, we got to play with a little more pace and then finish with poise down on the other end of the floor. It'll be a fun half here.
Yeah, sounds great, Coach. Appreciate the time. Best of luck this second half.
Thanks, Nate. Appreciate you.
All right, thank you, Nate. What a first half of basketball, full throttle, with these defenses just playing fantastic basketball. There's Brandon Valley getting a bucket there. But pressure has been the problem, as Abdouche, the all-time steals leader, making things difficult. Paget getting the bucket in the paint there. She was held to just 6 points in that first half. Moore with the jumper there. Down low, that's Trevine, the hoop and the harm. Kellenberger comes back the other way. Check that was Deckard with the shot. Here's Abdouche connecting on a three-pointer. Just full throttle basketball as Abdouche connects again from the outside. Kellenberger got that one to fall on that little baseline jumper. She had 4 points in the first half, as did Kiever. Six for Paget, leading the way for Brandon Valley. Meanwhile, seven for Moore, six for Abdouche, five for Trevine. They're the top scorers for the Lady Knights. The one thing that may be a concern is foul trouble. Three against Condon, two each against Kellenberger and Reese. Those are those players that provide tough perimeter defense for Brandon Valley, but they've got to be a little careful with those fouls accumulating.
Yeah, no question. And some of it is how aggressive they play, and so you don't want to peel that back too much. But they got to play smart. They got to show their hands. They got to play with their feet. No simple reach fouls.
Kellenberger and Paget up top on that zone. And there's the mid-range jumper from Abdouche, and it's good.
It was a great set play coming out of half with a step-up ball screen, getting Abdouche into a wide-open pull-up.
Kellenberger gets by a defender, and Abdouche taps it away from her. Got to have eyes in the back of your head if you're playing against Molly Abdouche, because she is going to find her way to the basketball and make a play on either end of the floor.
Yeah, O'Gorman does such a great job of, if you do defeat their press, of those back taps, of getting back into the play. You got to have an awareness of it. Get that ball in your outside hand. Get rid of it quick.
Deaver gets the inbounds. And now Paget will run the show. Gives way to Deckard. She'll get it back and launch a three. No, but the long rebound will be collected by Turvine. She's on the move through traffic, and she's going to be fouled. Two free throws coming up.
Yeah, and you just feel like Brandon Valley, the we've talked about it, they're going to attack the paint very aggressively, but they can get some three-pointers to drop. And there, Deckard had a pretty good look. They get some three-pointers to drop. That's going to be a huge aid to their attack against this half-court zone against O'Gorman.
Trevine got one of two that fouled to Paisley Hoff, her first, team's first. Just underway, and O'Gorman extends the lead to four. Here's Paget. Giever on the move. Offensive foul. Second foul on Giever as Okoye went down hard, took that charge. Let's check it out again.
And there's Okoye again. Brings so much to their defense. You know, you talk a lot about the havoc that Abdouche and Moore and their perimeter Trevine can, and you talk about Eggert at the point of that press, but Okoye just anchors everything that they're trying to do.
Zone defense coming out pretty far. Opens it up for Okoye. There's the open shooter, Trevine. No, rebound Giever.
Well schooled by Okoye there. Immediately look opposite.
Paget gets it across the timeline. Picks up her dribble. Giever, gets a nice pass from Hoff.
I wasn't sure if that initial one was going to squeeze through there to Hoff. And then Hoff goes quick. Click pass right to Giever for the finish.
2-point advantage for O'Gorman.
Now both teams have kind of settled in. The pace is a little bit slower so far these first couple minutes of the second half.
Into Okoye. She had to collect it, but finds that was Eggert who missed the shot. The ball ends up in the hands of Brandon Valley. And we're going to have a foul in the backcourt.
It's actually probably not a terrible foul, as that they had a deep outlet to Pageant there, and she was going to be off to the races.
Eggert with the foul, her first, team's first. Both teams, I think, are comfortable at this pace. Giever has to throw it outside to Pageant. Tapped away by Okoye, picked up by Eggert.
Such good length to her, just go-go gadget arms, pokes it away. Oh, and there's a nice find. Molly Abdu, some of the best vision in the state.
Eggert scores the easy bucket. The lead is four. Here comes Pageant on the move. She'll get it back from Kellenberger, now Deckert. Rifles it in, and there is a block on the shot by Giever. And it went out of bounds, and they say off the body of Giever, it's going to go, or she slapped it out, one of the two, but either way, it's O'Gorman basketball with 5:12 left, third quarter.
And they're getting the ball where they want to. They're getting it to Giever inside. Just the conversion level right now against the Koi's length isn't great.
Here's Abdouche, in and out. Giever collects the rebound.
That would have been a big one right there. Extended it to seven, just in and out.
There's the open shooter. Good! Kellenberger!
One win in and out, one nothing but net, 1 point game.
Abdouche floats one up and scores from mid-range. She's got 10. Pageant scans the defense.
Better get it across, yep, just in time.
Kellenberger. Kellenberger! And that's going to be on Okoye, and that's going to be her third.
Ava Kellenberger coming to play here thus far in the second half.
We got a game, folks. We'll be back in a moment with more of this championship girls AA basketball game right here on SDPB3.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
Maybe the loudest place in Sioux Falls tonight when it comes to music is the Pentagon in Sioux Falls, as the fans are into it here. And we've got a barn burner of a game going between O'Gorman and Brandon Valley. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toome. The free throw is good, and we are tied. Kellenberger with the old-fashioned three-point play. Intensity level. Ratcheted up high. Moore, a three off the mark. Tipped around once, and that's going to be off of who? We're going to say off the links. Kellenberger can't believe it. It's going to stay with O'Gorman.
Yeah, Moore just didn't probably get as well balanced as she normally is shooting that one.
Eggert, the high post, tries to maneuver through the paint. Lost the handle, out of bounds. It goes to the links.
And that's what we talked about. When the ball hits in there, it just It's so difficult, unless you got a one-on-one and they don't pinch down on you, to dribble through two or three bodies. That's got to be a catch, turn and shoot, or catch, look opposite. There's Sidney Tervin.
And Lease is going to get a foul, and that's a big one because that's three on her. She's one of the key reserves for Brandon Valley. A lot of time left in this third period. And quickly a sub to the scores table. That's Condon, but she also has three fouls.
Brandon Valley up to 10 turnovers right now in this game, and that's a piece, one of the keys to the game that we discussed.
And Deuce scans over that zone defense. Drives in, bottled up, nearly taken away. And who's it going to? Sioux Falls O'Gorman. 23 on the shot clock. Abdouche gets it in from Moore. Peterson, third guard in that set. Kellenberger got a hand on it.
Such great hand activity, and the amount of deflections that both of these teams get, and that's something that coaches constantly talk about, constantly chart, just makes throwing. There's a nice flash and finish. You don't often just get those easy direct line passes against either of these teams.
Salter lobs it ahead to Padgett. Inside Salter, no, but she's going to draw a foul and some free throws. Eggert, her second. Salter 0 for 2 in the first half from the free throw line.
Yeah, Salter's found herself with a few point blank opportunities. She just almost, and there she obviously gets fouled, but she's almost kind of rushing the shot and just trying to, the pace of the game has her sped up a little bit finishing. You got to take a deep breath, have poise, have patience. To get the ball in there, you got to capitalize.
That one no good, and Tervin with the rebound. Fights out of a crowd. Wants to get it to Moore, does so near the center circle. Moore throws it outside, taken away by Condon. Tipped out of her hands by Tervin. It'll stay with the Lynx. Another turnover. So they're going to bring in Giever and pull out Hoff. So the two post players in the lineup at the same time for Brandon Valley.
Yeah, we've seen them utilize this lineup sparingly here in the tournament.
Padgett fakes the three. Giever calling for it in the high post. Salter steps outside to take a pass. Giever up high. We'll throw it to the corner.
Under 10 in the shot clock.
And we're going to have a foul. And a look of astonishment on the face of Eggert. And she will get personal foul number 3. That sends Okoye to the scorer's table.
And as long as Julia Eggert is, she's just not quite as long as Owang Okoye. You know, Owang Okoye is just a different type of presence when she's in the game defensively, at least at the back line.
Okoye in, Eggert out for O'Gorman. We're tied at 32. Brandon Valley has the lead. Earlier, the first game of the year was 65-28. O'Gorman with the win. Not the same thing happening tonight. And Kent Colesrew would have probably been the first to tell you that it's not going to be like that again tonight. And there's Okoye drawing a foul in the paint.
No question. Both coaches knew. Everybody, you and I knew. Everybody in the gym knew this was going to be a possession-by-possession game with how these two teams have been playing here.
Giever got her third foul. No. Hung on the rim a long time, did not fall.
Only one of three now from the foul line for Okoye.
That one's good. We're tied again. Paget. Lobs it up ahead. Kellenberger for three. Too strong. Giever with the rebound. She's going to try to muscle it up, and Apoy just stuffed that one. Moore over to the corner. Abdouche in and out. Trevine has the rebound and a jump ball. Possession arrow, Brandon Valley.
Abdouche has had two of them here in the second half that have just rimmed in and out.
We have a sub at the scorer's table. Hoff in. Giever will get a break with a minute 34 left in the third.
Coach Kohlsrud was trying to get that quick timeout right in front of the official before the tie-up, but couldn't quite get it.
Kellenberger in the front court. Everyone runs by her. Now she'll set up a play. Hoff in the blocks, goes against Okoye, throws it outside. Who's it off of? Off of Kellenberger, out of bounds to the Lady Knights.
The Lady Knights gonna get a 2-for-1 here.
Potentially.
Yeah, potentially, depending on rebound situations, but.
Condon gets a steal. Oh, but throws it away. Coach Zerb back there telling her to settle it down.
Oh, yeah, well, he's applauding the effort at first, yeah.
Pass tipped. But Abdouche gets it. Now Lucy Moore. Round a double team.
So quick, it's just tough to trap her or Abdouche.
Ruby Moore, three, short. Rebound, Paget. Paget. Go to Condon. She's open, fakes the three. There's Kellenberger, no good. Hoff tried to pass it to a teammate. Here's Salter, yes!
A bunch of interior passing going on by the Lynx.
13 seconds left. Trevine. Oh, Condon almost got a steal. Okoye turns around to the baseline, throws it up, no good. Here's a pass ahead, and Condon can't catch up with it, but Brandon Valley has the lead. 35-33 as we head into the final period of regulation. The championship game on the line here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Class AA girls basketball on SDPB3.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do, and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Brandon Valley outscored O'Rourke 13-10 in that third period of play. The Lynx on top by two. O'Gorman starts the period with the basketball. Lynx fans, their student section making a whole lot of noise. And here we go. Trevine being chased by Kellenberger. Gets down the lane, pull up Jay. No, gets her own rebound and draws a foul. And it's going to be on Hoff. If so, her second. Yep, it is her second. Free throw good by Tervin, who has 9 on the night. 58% on the season from the charity stripe.
5 rebounds, 2 assists for Sydney Tervin. Active defensively. Been playing a good all-around floor game.
Padgett, check that. Kellenberger is going to be fouled. And she hit the deck hard. Tervin, that's her first foul. Remember, team fouls reset at the beginning of a period. They will not reset if we go into overtime. Padgett through traffic. Kellenberger open for 3. No. Giever rebound. Foul.
Giever's just tough to move there on the weak side. Ball bounces over and she just, yeah, they're trying to move her body, but with that strength and size.
Tervin quickly her second foul. That free throw no good by Giever, 65% on the year. That's her first free throw attempt tonight. She averages 7.5 points, over 5.5 rebounds a game, but that free throw is good. She has 7 on the night. Near steal there as Tervin runs right to the bucket and scores.
With the great Euro step there around Giever in the finish.
And there's a tip pass, turnover, Abdouche to Tervin. Cross court, Moore's going to drive, floats it up and in. Timeout, Brandon Valley with 6:52 left. O'Gorman has opened up a 3-point lead thanks to their defense.
Yeah, and that is where they are at their absolute best. Turning their defense into offense. They can spurt on you so quickly. You get a bucket, you get a turnover, you get another bucket, and then all of a sudden you're down 3 rather than being up 1.
Moore, Ruby Moore, number 24, the 5'8 freshman, took it right into the paint, found an opening, and got the bucket. Big play there by the freshman.
Yeah, with Eggert having 3 right now on the bench. Coach Colzer's been rolling with the freshman, and she's certainly not playing like one right now.
We've seen a lot of talented underclassmen at this tournament. And now the full court pressure being applied by the Lady Knights. Off the trigger. She'll get it to Padgett. Padgett has to collect it. Just got it across the timeline. 5 count underway. There's a 3 partially blocked. McCoy saves it. And we're going to have a jump ball, I believe. Possession arrow favors the Lynx.
I think that was, that Abdouche that went flying across the court to contest that shot and get a piece.
We'll throw it in. Kellenberger pulls it away. Bounce pass to Deckert. Here's Padgett along the baseline. Drives into the paint. And she is going to be fouled.
It's great awareness there by Padgett. She almost hurt her ability to stay on balance through contact. Still with her chin up. If that wasn't a body call right there, would have been a nice easy deuce for Giever.
Moore, Ruby Moore got her 3rd foul, and that pass is tipped, but Deckard tracks it down. Here's Padgett into the paint, pull up Jay, no. Giever fighting for it. Vern McCoy, jump ball, possession arrow, O'Gorman.
You're gonna take that look every time as Coach Zur and Brandon Valley. Ava Padgett point blank. She's not missing too many of those.
Padgett has yet to score in the second half. Tervin down the lane, floats it up, no, gets her own rebound. Blocked by Giever. Condon on the move. We checked that, it was Deckert. She passed over to Padgett. Hoff looking inside. Paget. High post. Giever turns. There's the open shooter. Short. And the rebound. Okoy off her fingertips out of bounds. Going to stay with the Lynx.
Brandon Valley sending there. Kellenberger ran from one baseline to the other with the baseline runner. They reverse it. Wide open corner three for him. That's good offense.
There's a pile up. Players hitting the deck. Picked up by Abdush, who will score. She's got a dozen.
Lucy Moore with a tremendous hustle play. Gets on the deck. Knocks it forward to extend the lead to five.
Timeout called by head coach Mike Zur to save the possession. They're about to get a 10 count. Biggest lead we've seen in a while, 5 points for O'Gorman with 5:10 left to go.
You just feel like over these last couple of minutes and these last few possessions, they've handled overall that full court press pretty well. Having Coach Zur said, I think they only had basically two turnovers that were truly against that press and pressure, and then the other one just kind of came in the flow of the game. And lately they've just been a little bit more stagnant against it, not really getting anybody to the middle of that press. You need somebody, you want a middle option, you want a sideline option, you want a reversal option, beat that thing and then attack it on the other end.
Fans making some noise here. Check out some of the stats. 3-point land, neither team shooting well. Brandon Valley 2 of 9, O'Gorman 3 of 13. 15 of 39 from the floor for O'Gorman, 12 of 39 for Brandon Valley. Free throws, 10 of 14 for the Lynx, 8 of 13 for O'Gorman. Dangerous moment in this game for Brandon Valley. They cannot afford to fall much further back, not against this defense.
There they try screening the top of it. O'Gorman does a nice job defeating those screens. No advantage gained. Shot clock running down.
They're gonna have to throw it up. And they launch it, and it's a shot clock violation. Timeout on the court, 4:43 left. O'Gorman up by 5. We'll be back in a moment right here on SDPB3.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Atmosphere here inside the Pentagon. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toome. O'Gorman is up by 5.
No turnovers thus far in the second half for O'Gorman versus Brandon Valley, who are currently up to 15 turnovers. Been a huge difference, especially here in this fourth quarter.
O'Gorman with the ball after the timeout. Shot up, no good. Rebound, O'Gorman. Abdush keeping it alive, and a timeout called by O'Gorman. They want to settle things down. Now it's their first timeout that they've spent. That's a good timeout by Coach Kohlsrud.
Yeah, didn't like the amount of traffic. Tip pass. Trevine tried passing it out of there a couple different times, and that's both of these teams are just so swarming defensively. It is. It's no secret that they're here right now. They're so difficult to play offense against. We touched on it, the amount of deflections that each one of them gets. just really impressive for somebody that appreciates some solid defense, Steve. This is a good game to watch.
For Brandon Valley, even though there's a lot of time left, 5 points seems like almost 10 points against this defense.
Yeah, they just have whether it's their ability to turn you over or their ability to force you into tough contested looks.
Ball's loose on the floor. It's going to Brandon Valley. There's Hoff making a play defensively. Brandon Valley coming the other way. 5 seconds to get it across the timeline. And there's a steal. Abdouche layup. Got it. Now it's a 7-point lead. Salter throws it ahead. Paget going to challenge Okoye. Salter gets the rebound, and she was pushed from behind. And I think that's going to be on Lucy Moore. It is her third.
That's the thing about pressure. It just has a tendency to just wear on you. And they do it over and over, and they're not, they play seven, but man, in great condition. And it's just having an effect on this Brandon Valley team here, especially in the fourth quarter.
For Brandon Valley, they cannot afford to have too many empty possessions the rest of the way, even though we got a lot of time left. Here's a long three, in and out. Rebound, O'Gorman. Abdouche will bring it up. Let's see if O'Gorman will bleed some time off the clock, or they're going to go in attack mode. They go in attack mode, miss the shot, and we're going to have a foul on the rebound. Moore looks astonished.
Gotta be shooting free throws, as that's their fifth foul.
And Moore just fouled out of the game. Her career ends with 7 points on the night. A lot of emotion over there on the sideline for Lucy Moore, 5'7" senior. What a tournament she has had. She will be a spectator the rest of the way.
Yeah, just trying to make a hustle play there. That's tough. And Coach Cole Drew knows he's in a state championship. He's gonna roll with his horses. And that was just an unfortunate one.
That free throw was Padgett's first point of the second half. She got them both. Desperately needed points there for Brandon Valley. They're still down by 5.
Just such a luxury to have not only Lucy Moore, but Molly Abdu. So even if you lose one handler, you still got another one that's.
And we're going to have a foul. Look out. Players getting tied up. And that's going to be a foul on O'Gorman. And that's going to be on Terveen. That is her third foul. Free throws the other way. Padgett back at the line for 2. So a golden opportunity here for the Lynx to score with the clock stopped at 3:03.
Yeah, the other thing it does is Olivia Padgett finally sees the ball go in, which hasn't happened a ton tonight. Only 1 of 8 from the floor, but she's 6 of 6, 7 of 7.
The lead is 3. Under 3 minutes to go. And an unforced error as Edward took her eye off the ball right into the O'Gorman bench. Now the Brandon Valley fans starting to rise to their feet.
Yeah, and Eggert hadn't been in the game for a while there as they were rolling with the smaller lineup. Comes in a little cool off the bench.
Deckert down low. Salter's going to try to muscle it up. Blocked by Okoye. Off of Salter's shoulder. Out of bounds. It goes to the Lady Knights. Coming up on 2.5 minutes to go. And O'Gorman calls a timeout. They will have, I believe, 3 remaining. They spend a full timeout.
Yeah.
2:31 to go.
Coach Colesrud's having Peyton Peterson check in. getting Egger going back there again, just like with Lucy Moore, going back to the smaller lineup. One possession game here, 2:31. A lot of time, but he wants to get something set up and utilize this possession here offensively. They can go up two possessions, as we talked about. I know it's a lot of time, but it just completely changes the feel and the flow of the game. Then all of a sudden you get a score stop and a score, and it's a entirely different ball game.
Stick around for the awards. The trophies handed out. We'll also have the all-tournament team announced at the conclusion of this contest, whenever that may be. Timeout situation. Three left for both squads. Brandon Valley has only committed one foul, so they got three to give. But every time O'Gorman commits a foul, two free throws coming for Brandon Valley. Lynx as a team, 68% at the free throw line this year.
See what coach wanted out of the timeout.
Abdush driving, floats it up and in. That's pretty basic.
Yeah.
Give the ball
so
to Molly
tough.
And let her
so
make a
tough.
Play.
Give it to my best player and a heart attack with that right hand.
Oh, dangerous pass. O'Gorman really applying the pressure. Lease was open, fakes, had a player fly by her. There's a player open in the corner. Kellenberger drives and scores.
Rather than settling for the three, Ava Kellenberger takes two dribbles. Nice, easy pull up.
Turveen into the front court all the way.
You gotta love, among many things with Sydney Turveen, is she's fearless. She's fearless out there, attacking the rim. Doesn't matter who, doesn't matter if Salter's back there.
Padgett got the foul, her first, team second. Big play by Sydney Turveen. Makes it a 6-point lead. Condon at half court. Lobs it over the corner, a three on the way, short. Rebound, Lady Knights, foul in the backcourt. It's going to be on Amanda Lease, and that is her fourth personal foul. She'll check out in favor of Hoff. Third team foul on Brandon Valley. Little over 90 seconds left. 6-point lead, O'Gorman.
This is a must stop situation here if you're Brandon Valley.
They get it up court to Peterson. She's in trouble. And we've got a timeout called by the bench by O'Gorman. 30-second timeout.
Coach Colger quick on it. Peyton Peterson was right in that Coffin's corner across half court, pressed up against the sideline. Quick timeout here. Still 31 seconds on the shot clock.
And that's something that has changed over the years, where the bench can call timeouts. It used to be the player that had the basketball was the only one that could call a timeout. Then it changed to any member of the team could call. Now the bench can call timeout. And that has saved many a possession over the years.
No question about that. Yeah, some different levels. They've changed some rules with that, even collegiately, and then kind of switched it back. And yeah, now I don't even know what it is now. If you can still do it under, I think in college, maybe coaches can call them under 1 or 2 minutes now.
As we get back to action, two timeouts left for O'Gorman, three left for Brandon Valley. Brandon Valley has a foul to give. A lot of time on the shot clock.
Still staying really aggressive.
Abdush looking, finds the open shooter. Good! Peterson's first points of the night. A monumental bucket, and there's Turveen over the pass. Moore scores. Oh. Under a minute. Salter lobs it up. No. Tip to Terveen. And there's the foul by Condon. And the O'Gorman fans, just like that, they're celebrating because this went from a 6-point lead to an 11-point lead in the blink of an eye.
Hayden Peterson comes off the bench with the huge corner three.
And then Ruby Moore with the nice finish. She has 6 points in the game. And Abdouche will be fouled by Kellenberger. And now we will march to the other end of the court for free throws. And O'Gorman, they struggled against Stevens, putting it away at the line. But that was like a 3-point game. A lot less pressure now with an 11-point lead and 46 seconds left.
Two folks that come off the bench for them making gigantic plays.
Abdouche misses that one. This is our first time at the free throw line tonight, 70% on the year. And that one will not fall. Padgett gives way to Decker, can't fire the three. Kellenberger looking for a screen. O'Gorman really guarding that 3-point line. Time ticking away. Now here's Salter floating it up too strong, and Terveen is just going to wrap it up, and that ought to do it. A valiant effort tonight by Brandon Valley, but the defense of O'Gorman just too much. The turnovers in the fourth quarter really hurt Brandon Valley.
Brandon Valley just obviously feeling that disappointment right now. They do have a couple seniors in Paisley Hoff and Kennedy Decker, two auxiliary players. They'll be bringing back Kellenberger and Madison Giever, and wouldn't be surprised to see him in this situation again next year.
Salter will be coming back. Terveen, what a game she has had. 17 points. And we're going to have an offensive foul. Yes. Padgett will get her second, and another play by Okoye. She has only scored 2 points on the night, but she has been monumental defensively.
In fitting fashion right there, Okoye. Yes, she's been such a factor around the rim. Has forced Salter 1 of 8 from the floor, Madison Giever 3 of 7 from the floor, and a lot of that is just Okoye's length inside.
A lot of emotions over on that Brandon Valley bench as Abdouche looking to just dribble this one out. A few seconds left, and this ball game is over. It's a perfect season for Sioux Falls O'Gorman. This game in the fourth quarter, she was very emotional. Different kind of emotions now as her team carried it all the way home. A hard-fought fourth quarter. O'Gorman outscores Brandon Valley 22-7 in that final stanza, and they are undefeated state AA girls basketball champions. And Brandon Valley, again, no reason for them to hang their heads. They played hard. They played a good game tonight, but it was just too much of that O'Gorman defense.
Brandon Valley, after being down 7 in that fourth quarter, cut it to 3, and then the O'Gorman Lady Knights with the huge response, and there's a reason why they are undefeated and nobody has beat them the entire year. Such an impressive season.
Let's turn it over now to Greg Thompson. Let's have some awards handed out.
What a great game. Good evening. We now like to present the awards to the teams that played for the championship of AA girls basketball. to present the awards from the South Dakota High School Activity Association Board of Directors, Danny Walking Eagle and Ryan Rollinger, along with Activity Association corporate partners from Sanford Health, Mandy Hoff, from Farmers Union Insurance, Stacy Menger, and from the South Dakota National Guard, Sergeant First Class Steve DeVos. First of all, let's give both these teams a round of applause. And now let's present the runner-up awards to the Lynx of Brandon Valley. Number two, Ava Kellenberger. Number three, Kennedy Deckert. Number five, Madison Giever. Number 10, London Giever. Number 12, Addison Hunsed. Number 14, Amanda Leese. Number 20, Reese Condon. Number 22, Mallory Babb. Number 24, Paisley Hoff. Number 32, Olivia Paget. Number 34, Evie Hoff. Number 40, Gracie Salter. Number 42, Annika Peterson. And number 44, Brooke Burnett. Managers, Iveta Irapka and Madison Trout. Assistant coaches, Maggie Dady, Jeff Lochner, Kenny Paula, and Emma Tervier. And accepting the runner-up trophy for the Lynx of Brandon Valley, head coach Mike Zurr. And now let's meet your champions, the Lady Knights of O'Gorman. Number three, Talamani. Number 10, Peyton Peterson. Number 11, Lucy Moore. Number 13, Abby Makuska. Number 15, Molly Abdush. Number 20, Claire Benson. Number 21, Ruth Dvorachek. Number 24, Ruby Moore. Number 25, Kyra Hermanson. Number 30, Sydney Terveen. Number 31, Julia Eggert. Number 35, Awang Okoy. Number 41, Lizzie Catman. Managers, Trenton Fisher and Sydney Vandenhamel. Assistant coaches, Christian Rydell, Dan Hughes, Crystal Richter, Barry Matthews, and accepting the championship trophy for the Lady Knights of O'Gorman, head coach Kent Colzerud. Thank you. We'd like to direct your attention to the center of the playing court as we present the All-Tournament Team Awards. The All-Tournament Team is selected by the South Dakota High School Basketball Coaches Association. As the names of the All-Tournament Team members are announced, each tournament team recipient should come to the awards area to pick up their plaque and then take a picture, and then we'll take a picture of the entire team. Your All-Tournament Team, from Rapid City Stevens, Talia Porter. From Mitchell, Sawyer Stabner. From Pierre, Reese Terwilliger. From Pierre, Lennox Dupree. From Harrisburg, Jaylee Hofer. From Harrisburg, Abby Flanagan. From Jefferson, Jaden Dunn. From Jefferson, Brinley Altenberg. From Brandon Valley, Madison Giever. From Brandon Valley, Olivia Paget. From O'Gorman, Lucy Moore. From O'Gorman, Molly Abdouche. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the All-Tournament AA Girls Team. O'Gorman will have a celebration of the tournament championship Monday at 5 o'clock in the cafeteria. 5 o'clock Monday in the cafeteria.
Congratulations to those young ladies making the all-tournament team. That is quite an honor. And congratulations to O'Gorman. They cap off a perfect season with a state championship. As those young ladies getting their picture taken, we got a couple of more players that got to get into the photograph here, a couple of Harrisburg players. And one of them on crutches there, that's Jaylee Hofer. She had a little tough time getting down there. We'll set those crutches aside as she gets her award there. Congratulations to those ladies and the all-tournament team for 2024. All of them very, very deserving. Let's take a timeout. We'll come back with more here from the girls AA basketball tournament. You're watching SDPB3.
Dreamer, doer, difference maker. These are just a few things we look for when growing our team at Dakota Bank. Those with empathy and a commitment to doing what's right build their careers with us. If you're about relationships and helping others, Dakota Bank is calling. Will you answer? Go with integrity. Go with teamwork. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Lucky for us, life is full of choices, big and small, just as it should be. They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose, a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business. Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
Welcome back. O'Gorman prevails 55-42, but the final score not indicative of just how close this game is. Let's send it down to Nate Kading.
Coach, for about 28 minutes or so of that game, it was a back and forth battle. Talk about your perseverance, your stick-to-itiveness of this group.
Yeah, I mean, we got to tip our hat to Brandon Valley. They played a great championship game, and our kids are just resilient, you know. We talked about all year long, sometimes our pressure and our running in transition doesn't take effect until later in the game. And thought maybe we wore them down a little bit and got some nice steals and layups and hit some big plays. Sydney Trevine stepped up big time, made some huge plays. Molly Abdouche, just so proud of these kids.
Obviously, you mentioned the big guns. How about Peyton Peterson coming in off the bench, Lucy Moore coming in with the spin move? What did that depth, having that depth and those couple kids coming off the bench mean to you guys all year long?
It means a ton. You know, you don't go 24-0 without having a lot of really, really good basketball players. And Lucy Moore, the things she did throughout the tournament and what she's done for our program over 4 years, Peyton Peterson accepting her role and hitting a huge three-pointer right there. And you know, we could go on and on with each and every kid, just what they gave to this team throughout the course of the season. And some of them had to sacrifice a little bit for the good of all. And just tremendously proud that these guys could go 24-0 against great competition, great coaches, kids that work so hard and win a state championship.
You touched on it. What does this mean to your program? This isn't the first time you guys been here, but 24-0, what does this mean?
Oh, I mean, it's tremendous. We've just been blessed with great kids and fortunate to be able to coach them. I've got a great coaching staff. Kids work hard, they buy into what we're doing, and just tremendously proud of what they've always accomplished.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
I think we're still here, Molly. Yeah, we're having some technical difficulties. That's just on me. Molly knows. Talk about, obviously, phenomenal feeling. What are the first things that are going through your head right now?
I'm just so happy. I mean, this is a surreal moment for us to be able to do this two times. And my career is amazing, and I'm just so proud of all my teammates. We've worked super hard, and we just deserve this so much.
What did you think was the separation in that game in a back-and-forth battle?
Yeah, I think our pressure really helped. You know, we had a lot of intensity coming out in that fourth quarter. We wanted it. I think we wanted it more. I think our pressure just got to them, and we were able to get some easy baskets on the other end.
No question. Hey, congratulations. Thanks for your time, Molly.
Good. Congratulations to O'Gorman and that young lady. What a stellar career. Number two all-time scorer, number one in steals, and a couple of state championships for her career, and she closes out a great career, undefeated season, state AA champions. We'll take a break. We'll come back and have stats and highlights from this championship game in a moment. This is SDPB3.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Our teams are committed to improving quality of life in our communities. Whether we're planning construction concepts, building a new downtown development, bringing new businesses to our communities, or maintaining your apartment home. we believe everyone deserves a well-built and well-managed place to live and work. This is Lloyd.
Oh my goodness.
You're committed to building relationships, to exceeding expectations, to serving your community. Your financial partner should share your vision and your values. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there, we'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
I was looking for something that was gonna be close to home.
Southeast Tech has definitely helped me. I'm actually doing something that I enjoy.
This is the right place to be.
Get your degree, get to work at Southeast Tech.
And welcome back to the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. The celebration continues for the O'Gorman Lady Knights. A perfect season, a hard-fought championship game as they are running to put the final plaque in place to denote that they are champions. Highlights from the second half here.
And Brandon Valley, a valiant effort, hung around for 3.5 quarters. Just that pressure, as coach talked about, wore him down.
Great play there by Kellenberger. She had a magnificent night with 14 points.
And Sydney Turveen, there you saw the clip, 17 points. 10 rebounds with the double-double, the X factor.
Yeah, and that young lady's just a sophomore for the O'Gorman Lady Knights, and there was a big shot by the freshman, Ruby Moore. That may have been the difference maker. Giever got a block one of the few times Turveen was stopped. Players were flying everywhere, but Molly Abdouche capitalizes off the turnover. Turveen again, the hoop in the arm. The three, this was maybe the dagger right there by Peyton Peterson.
Peterson comes off the bench, stone cold, with the huge shot that propels them to victory.
Those turnovers, that battle was pretty even, but a few more turnovers in that fourth quarter, 18-12. That led to a 22-7 scoring advantage for O'Gorman in that fourth quarter. Brandon Valley won the battle on the glass. Free throws relatively even. Three-pointers not much of a factor in this game, but O'Gorman forcing those turnovers, capitalizing, shoot a little bit better from the floor. 43% compared to 28% for Brandon Valley, as they just were aggressive all night, taking it right at Brandon Valley. Brandon Valley doing the same, but in the end, a few turnovers. There was that sequence with about 3 or so minutes to go that kind of doomed Brandon Valley. And yeah, O'Gorman claims the championship, but the final score not indicative of how close this game was.
Now, it's been their MO the entire year, and it's fairly fitting that that's what turned things here tonight.
It's been a great tournament. Nate, you did a fine job. Great working with you. We got to do this again sometime.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I enjoyed it, Steve.
And also thank you to Tony Schmidt, who helped us out on the first day. And I want to say thank you to all our technical people, our production crew, the engineers, the operations crew back in Vermilion, to making sure we get on the air. It's a team effort. This is a great crew here at SDPB, and I'm proud to be a member of it. And I'll be back next week from the Denny Sanford Premier Center for boys AA basketball. Looking forward to it. That'll be on SDPB3. On behalf of Nate Kading and our entire crew, I'm Steve Toombs, signing off from the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. You've been watching the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament here on SDPB3. Good night, everybody.